Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for the California Community College's Board of Governors meeting. The meeting begins at 12:30 p.m., but we will wait a couple minutes for people to log in. In the meantime, to access the Board of Governors meeting agenda, please visit our website at www.cccco.edu and go to the About Us tab drop-down menu. From there, click the Board of Governors, then Meeting Schedule, Minutes, and Agenda, and select the blue agenda hyperlink. As a reminder, closed caption is available. Click the CC icon at the bottom of the screen labeled closed caption to read live captions. Members of the public wishing to comment on an agenda item may use the raise hand feature to make a verbal public comment to the board. A member of the chancellor's office will announce your name and grant you the ability to speak. You are requested to identify yourself and present your public comment at that time. President Haynes, today is July 12, 2021. Would you like me to begin with roll call?
So sorry. Yes, but before we do the roll call, I just want to say good afternoon to everyone and to welcome you to the Board of Governors meeting. And if you will please start the roll call, that would be great.
Thank you. I will now begin roll call. Hildegard B. Aguinaldo. Darius W. Anderson. Amy M. Costa.
Present.
Tom Epstein.
Aye.
Felicia Escobar Carrillo. Jolina M. Grande.
Present.
Pamela Haynes.
Here.
Kevin J. Hall.
Here.
Lieutenant Governor Eleni Koulakis.
Present.
Jennifer L. Perry. Bill Rawlings.
Present.
Valerie L. Shaw.
Here.
Yulia Tarasova.
Present.
Las Villalobos. Joseph R. Williams.
Present.
President Haynes. We have 8 members present at this.
Darius is on.
Oh, thank you. We have Darius W. Anderson. Quorum is established.
Thank you so much for that. I'm glad we have a quorum now. So now that we have a quorum, we are now going to go into closed session. Am I correct?
President Haynes, would you like to do the Pledge of Allegiance first?
Oh, thank you so much. And I have a special person that I want to do it. So thank you for reminding me. Board Member Shaw, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag. Okay. The United States of America.
And
to the Republic for which it stands,
one nation,
under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you so much for that. And now we're going to go into closed session for approximately an hour. So I'll see you on the other side.
Christina?
The Board of Governors has adjourned to closed session and will return shortly.
No, this is the captioner.
My hand reappeared.
Welcome back, President Haynes and the Board of Governors from your closed session. Please let me know if you would like me to begin with a roll call.
Yes, please.
Hildegard B. Aguinaldo. Please.
Here.
Thank you. Darius W. Anderson.
Yes, here.
Amy M. Costa.
Present.
Tom Epstein. Felicia Escobar Carrillo.
Present.
Jolina M. Grande.
Here.
Pamela Haynes.
Here.
Kevin J. Hall.
Here.
Lieutenant Governor Eleni Kunalakis.
Present.
Jennifer L. Perry. Bill Rawlings.
Present.
Valerie L. Shaw.
Here.
Yulia Tarasova.
Present.
Blas Villalobos. Joseph R. Williams.
Present. Student present.
Tom Epstein.
Here.
Thank you. Quorum is established.
Good. We may need that other vote just in case. So just kind of keep her around. So we have just completed our evaluation of our chancellor. And thank you so much for the participation of the board. There's no other item or no other report. And with that, I'd like to I don't always do a president's report, but I think it's important to do one today. I'd first like to publicly thank my colleagues on the Board of Governors for all of your service on this board. You have been instrumental in your service relative to the budget. And I want to call out the one and only vice president of the board in her work behind the scenes relative to this budget. Not only did she keep some of us out of trouble, she has been instrumental in making certain that she shared her sage advice with us and asked key and critically important questions. I also want to talk a little bit about the agenda that we are about to go into. I can say without any hesitation that this agenda is a change document. And by change, I mean it is a document that stays true to the vision for success. It stays true to the change that we want to see in our system. And it's critically important. Each one of the items is critically important, but I want to note a few. We have an EEO document that really sets in place change for our system colleges and districts to really make certain that diversity, equity, inclusion is a part of that. And it's also holding accountable people like me, trustees, who serve on these boards and are serving with distinction of at least helping us know what our role is relative to these important issues around hiring, around the application process, around how we make certain embedded within our committees are the training that they need and the wherewithal to say, we're going to empower you to make certain that diversity, equity, and inclusion is part of your thinking, part of your the values that you hold. Another item on the agenda is the ethnic studies. And I don't know if my colleagues have had a chance to read some of the comments that came, and I'm impressed by the comments from our students. Our students who advocated in comment around the need for having ethnic studies and how it has and will make a difference in how they think, one, about their education, but how they engage in community, how they see not only themselves, in many cases, they didn't even understand the implications. And now they do, but then how they see their brothers and sisters in this work, and that they see that they have a voice to have a voice, and that it, and we give them license to give voice. And that's, I mean, it's profound in my estimation. We have another item on the agenda, which is the protection against discrimination. Protecting our transfer students so that they are not disproportionately impacted. each one of these items and a couple of others that I will mention need to be looked at holistically. It is about looking at our system. It's looking at the challenges that we have and making certain that we are addressing them in the right kinds of ways. We have also reaffirming the vision for success in the equitable placing, and that's relative to AB 705. It has been mentioned, and I will continue to mention it as well. I believe that AB 705 is a transformative piece of legislation that we are now implementing. And it is like anything that is profound and is transformational, it is not without its challenges. But I know that we as a system and as colleges and as districts, that we are going to work toward that, because it is our students that are benefiting for that equitable placement. And we need to do everything in our that is possible to make certain that, one, our colleges and our districts get what they need in order to be successful in that, because if they're not, then it means that our students are not. And then finally, we have an information item on the police academy and campus policing. And that was the result of the call to action that our chancellor made back in May and June. And it's critically important that we are looking at these particular issues, not just at the system level, but what it has caused, because we had that call to action and we supported that call to action. We have colleges and districts that are now looking at their own police departments, police units, and they're looking at curriculum and they're looking at what our officers are being taught. And so I wanna thank staff for all of the work that you've done. I think that this is an important meeting. It's but we have been doing this work all along, but I wanted to raise it up as an agenda that one can be proud of and recognize the work that we are doing and that we will continue to do. So with that, I wanna thank not only staff, but I know that a lot of hard work has gone through this process of putting this agenda together. But I also wanna thank the Academic Senate, the Student Senate. I wanna thank all of our trustees and CEOs through CCLC who have worked tirelessly to make certain that they had representation on our committees, that we heard their voices, and that these documents reflect those voices and the concerns and that have been raised, that we have made this work much more positive, much more accessible. And I also want to thank all of our stakeholders and our partners in this work, because none of us can do this work singularly. We all have to do it together and in collaboration. And so with that, I'll close those remarks and I'll ask our chancellor for his report.
Thank you, Board President Haynes, and thank you to the Board of Governors for another important meeting. And I want to also express my gratitude to everyone at the colleges. Hopefully they're enjoying their summer, getting ready for re-engaging students in the fall. And we're looking forward to doing everything we can to help them re-engage and begin to put the challenges of this pandemic behind us. So let me first begin my comments by acknowledging a very important member of the executive team. Today is the birthday of Dr. John Hetz, visiting executive to the chancellor's office. He is such an important part of the topics that we're discussing today, particularly AB 705, equitable placement in general, and much of the work that we're doing around analyzing our enrollment. So I just want to wish Dr. Hetz a very happy birthday on behalf of all of us. Now, let me begin my comments, my official comments, by thanking Governor Newsom and the state legislature for the much needed resources that are reflected in the recently adopted budget. Much of that budget reflected the Board of Governors' priorities. The Proposition 98 guarantee, we saw an increase of $17.7 billion. That's billion with a B. The approved 2021-22 State Budget Act are critical investments to advance the vision for success. We see $250 million in one-time emergency financial aid, which is sorely needed in our communities, $30 million ongoing, and $100 million one-time to support student basic needs. I want to thank the SSCCC and all the students who advocated for support of the challenges that they're facing. We see $30 million ongoing to support student mental health, as well as $115 million for one-time dollars for zero textbook costs to help continue to drive down the cost of education. $20 million one-time for EEO best practices, and $20 million one-time for culturally competent professional development. This will help us continue to implement the diversity, equity, and inclusion task force recommendations. We also see further investments in the Guided Pathways framework and its implementation, the Student Equity and Achievement Program, and $100 million ongoing for full-time faculty hiring so that our colleges can once again begin to hire our amazing faculty to help support the education of our diverse students. And initial investments to create a more equitable financial aid system, something that this board has advocated for many years, by removing the age limitations and time out of school restrictions for community college students that were once part of the Cal Grant system. With the infusion of these resources, our district leaders will be able to have new opportunities to meet students' needs, particularly in this moment of recovery from the pandemic. It's critically important that we focus on a recovery with equity, and these resources will help go a long way to do that. And finally, with regard to the newly adopted budget, I do want to acknowledge the governor and the members of the legislative leadership that continue to support Calvert College and the promise and innovation that the amazing faculty and staff of Cal Bright, our blossoming new college, are delivering. As Board President Haynes mentioned, we will be talking about equitable placement during this board meeting. The board will receive an update on the implementation of AB 705 and AB 1805, which we refer to as equitable placement. I want to express my gratitude to the college faculty, staff, and the CEOs who are working to ensure that students are placed in transfer level math and English in year one. The continued implementation of AB 705 with fidelity is critical to our students' future. We know that maximizing student placement increases student persistence and success. The spotlight we have today is an opportunity for our system to stay laser focused on the continuous improvement, which we must continue to do more of. So the dashboard that will be presented today by Dr. John Hetz and Dr. Aisha Lowe will be a critical tool to help support our districts, redesign technical support and professional development, and to empower our local communities with data. Shifting gears a little bit, earlier this year, I asked the Chancellor's Office team and the Success Center to work together to update the vision for success, to put it in the context of everything we have going on now. It's hard to believe that the vision for success is nearly 5 years old, but in that period of time, a lot has changed in the world. And so we wanted to put it in the context of what's happening today and the importance of equity to our agenda. So we have a new document. I know that I've shared the initial draft with many of you, I think with all of you. We will be releasing it soon to the field. It's titled Update to the Vision for Success, Reaffirming Equity in a Time of Recovery. And I want to thank many of the folks in the field that helped with this document. In particular, I want to thank President Keith Curry, President Ed Butch, President Juliana Barnes, President Tim McGrath, President Joe Wise, Chancellor Brian King, Chancellor Francisco Rodriguez, all of whom helped helped us refresh this document to put it into context, as well as president of our statewide Senate, Dolores Davison, and our past Student Senate President, Stephen Kodur, for sharing their experiences and informing the report. As I said, we will be releasing it soon, and it will continue to be the North Star for our system as we look forward to a recovery with equity as we move past this pandemic, and we look forward to a bright new future for our system and for our students. And speaking of our students, we will continue to put spotlight on them. We will continue to help inform the board and the public of the collective trauma of the past year that they've experienced, and continue to work with our community colleges to uniquely position them to help aid in our state's recovery. So in closing, I just want to thank all of our college faculty, staff, administrators, managers who continue to do the hard work of helping position our colleges to be that critical component in the recovery that we will experience and are experiencing here in the state of California. And with that, I will turn it back over to you, Board President Haynes.
Thank you so much for your report, Chancellor. We're going to move into the agenda at this point, and we have a consent calendar. If there's no questions, then I will accept or any discussion. I will accept a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second.
Okie dokie. I think.
Anderson Grande.
Who did the motion? Who did the first? Come on. What was
it? I heard Anderson Grande.
I heard Anderson Grande too. Thank you so much, Member Rawlings. So we have a first and a second. So can you call the roll?
Yes. Hildegard B. Aguinaldo.
Aye.
Darius W. Anderson.
Aye.
Amy M. Costa.
Aye.
Tom Epstein.
Aye.
Felicia Escobar Carrillo.
Aye.
Jelena M. Grande.
Aye.
Pamela Haynes.
Aye.
Kevin J. Hall.
Aye.
Lieutenant Governor Eleni Kunalakis. Bill Rawlings.
Aye.
Valerie L. Shaw.
Aye.
Yulia Tarasova.
Aye.
Joseph R. Williams. Aye. President Haynes, the motion passes.
Thank you. Then we're going to go into our action calendar. 4.1 is the approval of contracts and grants. Deputy Chancellor Gonzalez is the presenter.
Good afternoon, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, board members, Chancellor Oakley. Recognizing the time, I want to move quickly through this item and just remind you of three things. You see these contracts and grants in front of you, either because they are in excess of $100,000 over 3 years in duration, or for the purposes of consulting services over $50,000. This also applies to any amendment, which is certainly the case for two of the items in front of you today. Item one extends the I Can Afford College campaign. And so it utilizes the existing fiscal agent agreement to be able to send out the dollars with an expedited timeline. Item two continues to fund the Middle College High School program. There were 16 applicants. As you see in your item, it was competitive. All 16 actually got awarded. And this year our staff did something a little bit different. We utilized data to be able to award the different grants. That's what explains the different amounts that you see in front of you. So for achieving different outcomes, there were three different levels of grants awarded. Item three consists of a brand new grant that provides ongoing funding to the Academic Senate for California Community Colleges. This is always an existing line item in the Budget Act. However, it is considered new every single year. And the funds that are appropriated by the legislature are for the general operation of the Academic Senate. So things like committee, buying out time, the staff at the Academic Senate. Item four is a brand new interjurisdictional exchange, and that's when we borrow staff from a district. This is a one-year IJE for a Dean of Research and Data, critical, mission critical to the work that we are doing today. We currently have four research and data team members in our division here at the Chancellor's Office. And Dr. Denise Lee brings extensive experience in data, as well as data dashboards specifically for our system, and more importantly, how to use data for evidence-based decision-making. This is a one-year contract, so it is not a sustainable solution to meet our needs, but we believe it'll be critical over the next year, and more importantly, as we continue to advocate for additional positions in research and data, we know that we'll be able to outline the roadmap for those needs. Item five is a no-cost amendment. This one's fairly simple. These are the California Apprenticeship Initiative. There were three districts who, due to the pandemic, had a delay in their implementation. The six-month extension to their district contracts will allow them to utilize the dollars to maximize their impact on apprenticeship programs in our state. With that, I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Daisy. Are there any, I see Vice President Costa has her hand up. I don't see any other.
Yeah, thank you, Pam. I just have a quick question on the I Can Afford College. I'm wondering, because we've had some success this year with Cal Grant and certainly coming out of the pandemic, will any of the messaging be changed at all with these kind of new items?
Yes, we've done a lot of those changes, and I asked Vice Chancellor Paul Feast to join us here, anticipating such a question. Go ahead, Paul.
Yes, thanks for the question. Absolutely, we will be adjusting messaging when there are changes to eligibility in financial aid. In the past, we worked closely with our staff to get the messages right and to integrate that into our student-facing campaigns. And as you probably know, we've got some additional resources that have been provided in the budget for this year that will help to amplify those messages and get it out to students.
Other questions from board members? I don't see any other questions from board members. Is there public comment?
The public comment period for item 4.1 is now open. Please use the raise hand feature. If you are calling into the meeting, use star 9. A member of the Chancellor's Office will call on you and allow you to address the board. You'll have a maximum of 3 minutes. We have not received any written comments in this item, and I will now turn it over to Gary for any hands raised.
We have no hands raised at this time, so we can close public comment.
Thank you for that. So can I get a motion and a second for this particular item?
I'll move approval.
Rondé moves. Can I get a second?
Second.
Aguinaldo seconds. Can we get a roll call, please?
Hildegard B. Aguinaldo.
Aye.
Darius W. Anderson.
Yes.
Amy M. Costa.
Aye.
Tom Epstein.
Aye.
Alicia Escobar Carrillo.
Aye.
Jolina M. Grande.
Aye.
Pamela Haynes.
Aye.
Kevin J. Hall.
Aye.
Lieutenant Governor Eleni Kunalakis.
Aye.
Bill Rawlings.
Aye.
Valerie L. Shaw.
Yes.
Yulia Tarasova.
Aye.
Joseph R. Williams.
Aye.
President Haynes, the motion carries.
Thank you. Our next item is 4.2, which is the proposed regulatory action to amend the EEO, or Equal Employment Opportunity Regs. We have General Counsel LaForestier and also Deputy Counsel Villegas presenting.
Good afternoon, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, and members of the board. Thank you. Yes, we're here to present on second reading the Equal Employment Opportunity Regulations. The General Counsel's work on this has really been led by Mr. Villegas, so he will be presenting on today's item, and we will both be available for any questions that you may have.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Mark. And good afternoon, President Haynes,
Vice President Costa and members of the board. I'm really happy to be here presenting this item because it's a really significant step along the road to reforming our system's EEO programs to make them more effective in producing a diverse workforce within the California Community Colleges going forward. As President Haynes mentioned in her comments earlier, this work is very important in our quest to transform these programs to better advance our diversity, equity, and inclusion goals. As I'm sure you all know, this item relates to one of the DEI task force recommendations and the integration plan you adopted in 2019, which called for the Chancellor's Office to standardize and revise the EEO plan template that districts use to communicate their EEO programs. A district's EEO plan is important because it is the district's public-facing statement of its commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion with respect to employment. And it specifies what the district plans to do to advance the EEO goals. As we began this work, we realized that before revising the EEO plan template, it would be necessary to revisit the Title V regulations governing EEO programs to make necessary amendments that would provide a better framework for an EEO plan template with built-in intentionality and accountability. From the beginning, we knew that such an important effort would require buy-in from the various stakeholder groups that make up our system. Leading the effort was the DEI implementation work group, which came out of the DEI efforts. And that includes stakeholder organizations such as the Association of Chief Human Resource Officers, the Academic Senate for California Community Colleges, the CEO and trustee boards within the Community College League of California, the Association of Chief Business Officers, and the Student Senate for California Community Colleges. Of course, this being an EEO initiative, the work also fell within the purview of the statewide EEO and Diversity Advisory Committee, with which we worked in partnership to formulate the regulations that are before you. The EEO and Diversity Advisory Committee is itself made up of members of all of the aforementioned stakeholder groups, but also includes representatives from the Classified Service, the Association for California Community College Administrators, Chief Instructional Officers, and the Chief Student Services Officers in the system. Over the course of this year, we convened several joint meetings of the DEI Implementation Work Group and the EEO and Diversity Advisory Committee to gather input and suggestions and recommendations on the different things that all the different stakeholder groups felt were necessary elements of the EEO regulations. After lively discussion and follow-up, we drafted the regulations that were noticed for the 45-day period in May. And this is the draft text that you considered, that was presented to Consultation Council and then was considered by the board for first reading at the May 24th meeting. During the 45-day public comment period and during the joint meetings with the DEI Implementation Work Group and the EEO and Diversity Advisory Committee, we received a number of comments from representatives of the stakeholder groups, some of which necessitated minor changes to the initial draft of the regulations that we presented in May. Those comments and our responses are included in attachment 2 to the board agenda for this meeting. The changes were made to the regulations and re-noticed for an additional 15-day period as is required by the board's standing orders. We did not receive any additional comments regarding the changes to the text for second reading. I just want to briefly highlight some of the primary changes that we did make as a result of the comments received in response to the 45-day notice. These are the changes that are before you. First, with respect to changes to definitions in section 53001, a commenter had mentioned that the definition of equal employment opportunity should specify that providing equal employment opportunity includes the concept that when updating job descriptions, districts should make clear that qualifications for employment include a commitment to diversity. We agreed that this was an important qualification to include, and so we made that change. still within section 53001, we agreed with a commenter that the definition of screening and selection procedures should include a consideration of equivalency. Various groups throughout this process have noted that oftentimes a failure to check for equivalent qualifications serves as a barrier to entry to many diverse applicants. And so we made that change. With respect to changes to section 53005 regarding district advisory committees, at the May meeting, Member Fitzgerald asked us to consider explicitly mentioning and specifying that advisory committees at the district level should include students, faculty, and classified staff. And we agreed with Member Fitzgerald's suggestion that this change would serve to emphasize that these constituencies are important and have contributions to make and should be explicitly mentioned in the regulation. Going on, we also added a suggestion in that same regulation, 53005, from a commenter that the regulation should specify that in addition to the requirement that members of the advisory committee receive the types of training identified by the regulation, including training on non-discrimination laws, elimination of bias in hiring, and the educational benefits of workforce diversity, members of district governing boards should also receive that training. In essence, we agreed with the commenter that it is important to ensure that governing boards, as the ultimate hiring authority, understand these important concepts. In section 53021, we made an amendment to include a commenter suggestion that in recruiting applicants, districts should ensure that in addition to having the relevant job qualifications, applicants should also be equity-minded, as we believe that the ability to relate to and teach students of various backgrounds is and ought to be a job qualification to teach in our system. Along those same lines, and reinforcing that same concept in the next section, section 53022, we made an amendment to include a requirement that job announcements should include an explicit mention that sensitivity to and understanding of diverse academic, socioeconomic, cultural, disability, gender identity, sexual orientation, and ethnic backgrounds of community college students shall be considered a core system competency and job requirements. Again, emphasizing and reinforcing that concept that applicants should value diversity and inclusion in their teaching. In addition, section 53022 was also amended to require job announcements to mention the possibility of meeting minimum qualifications through equivalency. Again, as we previously mentioned, the lack of knowledge of the equivalency process is often a significant barrier to entry into our system. To summarize, these were the primary changes that were necessitated by the comments we received in response to the 45-day public notice. Again, we didn't receive any comments related to the revised text, and so no new changes were made to the text that is before you as a result of the 15-day comment period. These amendments, again, are a first step in accomplishing the DEA task force recommendations to transform the EEO plan template into a tool for change and accountability. After the adoption of these regulatory amendments, the Chancellor's Office will continue to work with the EEO and Diversity Advisory Committee and the DEI Implementation Workgroup to develop the new EEO plan template, and we will also be consulting with them on the issue of spending any new EEO funds received in the, that I believe are contemplated at this point by the legislature. With that, I'll conclude my presentation. And as Mark mentioned, we'll be available for any questions you have. And after the question period, I respectfully ask the board to adopt the recommendation and approve the text of the EEO regulations as presented.
Thank you for that presentation. Board members, are there any questions from our board? So I have Vice President Costa, Member Tarasova, and Board Member Hall, in that order.
Thank you, President Haynes. I have a series of questions, and then I'd like to make a comment. And, you know, I want to ground my comments in the fact that the overarching goal, I think, is a good one. As a board, we've long said that we want those that serve our students on campuses to reflect the students that they serve. And I view this as a step in the right direction and an update of a plan that will more positively impact that. I think my concern is one of governance, and it's really about the role of the chancellor's office versus those of the local districts. And I want to hear from some of my colleagues who are better versed in local districts. I certainly am not. I'm looking at Bill, Jolina, and Pam. But the questions I have are, you know, in the recently adopted budget, what's the proposed funding for EOE? Has the chancellor's office ever in recent history withheld funding from districts for failure to submit their plan? And lastly, kind of where within the chancellor's office would this workload exist? Kind of who would be conducting this work? Cognizant of the conversations we've had about needing more resources. And then after those through the chair, if okay, I'd like to make a couple of comments based on the answer.
Certainly. So Amy, I know that some of these questions probably should go to our, I'm not certain if you want your colleagues on the board who have experienced on the districts to take a stab at those, or if your preference would be for clarification purposes to have our deputy chancellor take a stab at them.
I think these are kind of factual questions. And then, you know, once I make my comments, I might open it up to my colleagues who have some local experience, because I may be completely off base and you guys got to tell me that.
All right, so I'm gonna defer to the chancellor's office.
Okay, I think I can jump in there and answer Vice President Costa's second question regarding whether we have ever withheld funds in the past from districts that did not submit EO plans. And the answer to that is yes, we did. We have withheld funds in the 2016-17 and 17-18 fiscal years. Those were the first years in which we introduced the multiple measures funding allocation formula, where districts had to certify that they had complied with a series of requirements, one of which being their creation of an EEO plan, as well as meeting other multiple measures.
Can I ask a question, though, for submission of the plan, or was it for other items that the district had to meet as a condition of funding?
I can't answer that because our records don't specify. The requirement was that the district submit the certification that included all of those different requirements. And in cases where districts did not receive the funding, it was because they didn't submit the form. They didn't submit the certification. And again, that was the first year of that new scheme in 2016-17 and 17-18. So in 16-17, we had about, I believe it was somewhere around 12 to 15 districts that did not submit. In 16-17, we got reduced to 4. You know, districts kind of got with the program. And since then, districts have submitted their certifications each year. So we haven't withheld money in subsequent years.
And I recall the same thing. It just that those numbers sound correct to me.
With respect to your question about who in the chancellor's office might do that work, I think I will defer to General Counsel LaForestier on that.
Okay, and I'd also invite Deputy Chancellor Gonzalez to chip in if she wants to. But for the work that involves reviewing the plans, we currently receive the plans that the districts complete, but we receive those after districts have approved them, and they're approved for a cycle of 3 years. One of the changes that we are making to these regulations is to allow us to see those plans beforehand. And that is to give us an opportunity to comment on them if we wish to the Board of Trustees, local boards of trustees, before they adopt the plan, so that they have our considered view of the content of the plans. Now, we're not required to comment. It's an opportunity for us to comment both to provide constructive criticism and maybe to applaud district plans, as the case may be. And it is not an approval process. I think that's an important point that goes to your question about governance. I think Vice President Costa, the Chancellor's office is not substituting its will for the will of the Board of Trustees, but we are putting ourselves in a place where we can provide some meaningful commentary.
Can I ask a fine question then, Mark?
Yes.
Under what circumstance would you withhold funds if it wasn't to judge in some way? Is it only for non-submittal?
So we are anticipating that there will be progress through the years and the plan is supposed to anticipate meeting objectives. So I think I think we have the ability to withhold funds in the future if there is not progress and that the boards are not adjusting their plans in order to achieve progress. I think in the absence of a specific circumstance, I think it would be hard for us to say, you know, what the trigger would be for withholding funds. We'll have to see how the districts do and whether they are complying with modifying their plans to address local circumstances.
President Haynes, I'm happy to answer some of the other questions as well. I think what's important to note here is this is not new workload. Our districts already have EO plans. It's required by the law. What this simply does is it transforms a document that is just compliance based. And what I can tell you is right now, it's as simple as, are you abiding by section blank, blank, blank? Yes, no. That's not something that gets us at progress, at outcomes. What this does is it allows our districts to dream, to reflect on where should we be in 3 years. So the idea of withholding funds at this point in time is probably something that we will keep on the table, probably not likely, especially as we are transforming and thinking about continuous improvement. What I will say is when we saw extreme compliance, and by compliance, we mean when we started to receive district plans, it was because the legislature appropriated dollars. So there is a direct connection there with submission of reports and dollars. That was 2016, 17, 17, 18 saw an influx. But our EEO funds are directly tied to the FOM, the faculty obligation number. And during this time period, there was an executive order that allowed districts to delay paying any bond penalties. So this year we do expect for that number to go down. It's also part of why the legislature and the legislative staff were really saw a critical need in EEO funds. So we do have the $20 million to advance equal employment opportunity best practices. We'll have to think very clearly about the connection between any new templates and full implementation of where we need to be in the next 3 years. In terms of withholding, I already mentioned we'll keep that on the table. I think it'll require a lot of conversations with our EEO DAC, the DI implementation work group, district leaders, because these are district plans. And then where will the work live? The work currently and has historically lived in our general counsel's office. With this work ramping up, and requiring and asking for our office to give more feedback, something that has been a successful best practice for our office in other areas, such as guided pathways, our student equity and achievement plans. It's important that we integrate now these plans. Certainly, you have been very supportive in the last two fiscal years to ask for additional positions. Specifically last year, you requested 3 EEO positions. And I will say that the Consultation Council and all of our colleagues in the system also supported that. We're hoping that that will be the case this year. In the short term, what does this mean? With these regulation changes, the plans will still be due every 3 years. So you can expect for our office to receive maybe 24, 25 plans within a year. However, the work does ramp up if we're going to give feedback. In the meantime, without any new state positions, we're hoping to bring on a consultant similar to what you just approved today, like an IJE, an interjurisdictional exchange, someone that is an expert in our districts with EEO, but more importantly on DEI, and can integrate this plan to the experiences of our students in the classroom, which is what this board has been supporting, right? How do we integrate DEI into the broader work of achieving equitable outcomes?
So Pam, can I make my comments and then you and Bill and Jolena can tell me if I'm crazy?
Okay, that sounds like a plan.
Colleagues, I don't want to just limit it to you guys, but you have the local experience. So I have to say with the sections 53003, 53024.2 and 53033, I just know that I can get here. I mean, I'm a fan of subsidiarity and I am going to respectfully disagree with our general counsel because I think the withholding of funds is de facto an approval or a rejection. And I think some of the work we do is better placed from a statewide perspective, which includes the work of pipeline development for historically Black universities and trying to attract faculty. I think that's an appropriate place for the chancellor's office. The workload, it exists, but it will be more. We're asking to see it 90 days before. I do believe there would be some pressures and maybe you guys have figured out how to address that. But for me, it really is fundamentally that I believe our districts want to do this work. And so I view our role as being one of support, not punitive or withholding of funds. And providing kind of best practices and resources. And if we're providing a template, I'm kind of perplexed as to what we're even reviewing when they submit it to us. And I believe that the elected boards have purview here versus somebody in the chancellor's office that's staff. And I learned long ago as a legislative staffer to not legislate to the lowest common denominator. And I have faith that our districts want to do this work and that we can provide them support to do that versus withholding funds for districts that, are already struggling under a lot of different things that we ask them to do. So anyway, you guys can tell me I'm crazy now.
So I'm gonna allow Bill and Jolena if they want to chime in and then I'll give you my observations. And then, so if you have any comments relative to that, because both of you are on campuses, you are.
We are.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I would just say, I think there was an adjustment the past few years as the legislature provided the funding for the EEO plans. And so I think there was the cognitive switch, I think, that happened at the campuses already. So I don't think this will be a big leap for a lot of us on our campuses. I do absolutely get your point, Vice President Costa, that you end up getting at a point where the trustees' ability to legislate is influenced by the relationship with the chancellor's office and with the funding that would go along with it, right? So there certainly is an impact there. I think for me, it hasn't been a real red flag, partly because it's a way of creating dialogue. And I don't imagine we're going to have very many colleges getting to a position where the funding would be at risk, partly because I do believe, as you do, that they want to do the work, but the financial incentive is definitely the incentive that over the years has made the needle move, right? Absent the financial incentive, I don't know that we would have gotten to the place that we're at today, much less where we want to go. But I think there is a lot of work getting done by the EEO committees on our campuses that would accelerate this work and get in a position where the losing the incentive, financial incentive, wouldn't be at risk.
Thank you.
In addition to what Bill just offered, I would say one other thing, very much in line with what you had suggested, Vice President Costa, and that is that the districts and the faculty, staff, the administration on our campuses, they want to do the work, and the funding makes it that much easier to accomplish the goals that are outlined in their EEO plans. And I will say from my campus in particular, we endorse our EEO plan through our Academic Senate, and it's there that the entire faculty body essentially verbalize and express their support for our EEO plan and make a commitment to perform the work, regardless of whether or not we're going to have the funding earmarked for it. Having the funding just makes the work easier to be done at scale.
And just really quick, Pam, if I may, before your comment, because I appreciate what both of you are saying. And I want to be clear, I want to give them the money. I don't want us to be able to withhold the dollars.
So I'm gonna obviously speak from the role of a trustee. And I'm also gonna speak from the position of Los Rios having Jake Knapp, who was in that department, completely revamp the EEO that Los Rios has moved to. And I'm not certain if there was enough money. I think there had to have been a commitment by the district to get this work done, because we went out to USC and had them do an assessment of our application process, our committees, all of those kinds of things that sort of are the glue to make certain of what was actually happening with regard to hiring, and then to give us a report back, and then to begin to revamp our application process. And we're still in the process of doing that. And we're doing it relative to equivalencies at this point. So we've moved on. I guess my point is, I agree. I don't, with you, Amy, and with others, I don't know that the dollars should be punitive, although there are those who are much more amenable and are on the front rows of doing this work, because they know how important it is. But it does require a board of trustees that really wants to do the oversight of this. It requires the commitment of faculty and staff and training. It requires a commitment of just revamping all of the application process and the questions. And when we initially looked at those questions and asked them of prospective candidates, the answers that we accepted prior to this assessment was gibberish. I remember reading one application, and they asked, how do you feel about diversity, equity, and inclusion? And the response was, well, every year I do a potluck that has all of the cuisines of all of the folks of color. That should not have been even considered. Although I like all those foods, that shouldn't have been an acceptable answer. And that's sort of an outward example, but it is in the questions and it is in the answers and being critical about someone's abilities in this area that we need to continually to look at. And so I think that the EEO plan and hopefully those dollars will go toward that revamping. And then the other piece that I think is really important in the change in these regulations is the role and an explicit role of the trustees. I say that because trustees, including myself, we need to be trained. We need to know what those values are. We need to be able to know how to apply them. And then to hold, and then to have that transparency, and then to hold our chancellor and the district or the colleges accountable for that, and to have the data to say, well, are we succeeding or are we not? Many of these hires are not hires for 1 or 2 years. once we get someone and once they reach tenure or once they get through probation, these are folks that are going to be with us. And so it is at the hiring stage that is critically important. And so I think it holds us to that, those elements relative to our hiring process and our values. If indeed we say we're about these things, it holds us to those values as well. And it does so on an annual basis, not just every 3 years.
And Pam, I was totally remiss in not asking Board Member Williams as well, who also
I see his hand, and I am going to take him out of order. Board Member Williams.
Yeah, I just want to agree with what was already said, but I think we should see the plan as a leading indicator, because it's not the actual thing, it's the implementation of the plan. And I want to just give a plug for the trustee fellowship. We got to invest in capacity building for trustees. And helping them understand how to dashboard some of this stuff out. Because ultimately it's up to them to say, yeah, this is something that we value and we're gonna monitor and inspect and make sure these things happen. Because when you look at some of the activity, like sometimes the activities are disjointed and, you know, I think they only are getting about $50,000 for this. It's not a lot of money. And so, but even when you look at some of activity, sometimes it's like, well, we're bringing in a speaker to talk about whatever, and it's like, okay, well, how is that going to increase the diversity of your hiring? And so, but helping trustees really get at the policy and the resource allocation level of how to really move the needle is where the work, I think, and you know, and I know we rely on CCLC and ACCT to do that, but I just think there's more that we can look at in terms of building trustee capacity to move some of these areas that we're identifying or as being important.
Thank you. Trustee Costa, have you get the answers?
I think so. I mean, I have to say, I just so folks know where I've landed is I want to invest in districts, and I don't know that having a bureaucrat in Sacramento really helps in a meaningful way as they look at this. And I was a former bureaucrat, so I'm not saying that in a pejorative manner at all. But anyway, thank you everyone for your perspective. I really appreciate it a lot.
Thank you. So we're going to take Board Member Tarasova, Board Member Hall, and then I see Board Member Anderson's hand raised.
Thank you, President Haynes. I want to take a moment to recognize and express my appreciation to the Chancellor's team for including the proposed changes from the last meeting. I would also like to acknowledge Student Senate for California Community College's active involvement in the DEI implementation work group this past year, and by specifically outlining the students as the part of the stakeholder group at the district level really highlights the commitment to continue this collaboration and equal opportunity for student voice to be represented locally, as the needs and the challenges of the districts might vary across the state. And especially since the plan focuses on the equity-minded practices for recruitment, hiring, retention processes, which ultimately really affects student success, as it is remains to be the only and the main guiding principle for California Community Colleges system as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you. Board Member Hall.
Thank you, President Haynes. This follows up a bit on Member Costa's concerns. So I agree, obviously, with the goal of increasing diversity of our faculty. We all do. We've been talking about that for years now. It's not just the faculty, as I understand it through Title V, it's the classified employees and leadership throughout our entire system. But I definitely have concerns about the method to accomplish that goal. Now, I went back and read Title V. I read the 29 or 30 pages that we have of strikeouts and additions. And I looked at it as a fairly progressive, robust template to follow. And I look at the revisions as Title V as written, I think gives us the tools to achieve our hiring goals without adding more mandates on a system that's already under stress. And I do think it expands this bureaucracy in Sacramento and is really dictating to the colleges about, you know, what to do in your individual colleges. It seems to me, and this is what Member Costa mentioned too, that it inevitably places more stress on the chancellor's office. And for the last couple of years, we've heard how the chancellor's office is understaffed. So, you know, we can't have what's written in Title V with the additions without an incredible workload increase on the chancellor's office. I think it also increases the stress on colleges with additional audits and production of written reports. I just got to believe people in general don't like to do these written reports, and this definitely increases that responsibility as I read the additions. One of the campus visits I did a couple of years ago, I met with the president of the school and the vice president and some other leadership members. And I said, well, is there something you want me to bring back to the chancellor's office? And they said, tell the chancellor's office, we don't want any more big initiatives coming down the pike from Sacramento. You know, we're dealing with all we can deal with right now. And I think that the proposal is calling on colleges to do additional things. And one of the things I noticed, I went back to the agenda from 2 months ago, and I think part of this process is the Academic Senate has a pre-hiring module with all these different questions. It just seems to me there are 14 headings and 31 subcategories of questions to ask pre-hire, hire, post-hire. It just seems like we're taking away the discretion of the colleges to do what I think they should do anyway, and what they're probably doing now as a matter of course anyway. I think Member Rollins and Member Grande mentioned that, at least at their colleges, this is happening. I don't think we want to take away the discretion of the locally elected officials of these colleges and tell them what to do from Sacramento. We have confidence in our local colleges to carry out this issue. But some of the questions that I had then were, I'll just list them. Does this impact or does it change the way we look at our tenured professors? And then how do we handle colleges that don't comply? There was some talk about withholding money, but I mean, if you're in Northern California or some other place and it's hard to diversify your faculty, what happens then? So those are just some of my questions.
So let me just respond, if I may, Member Hall, and some of this will hopefully address some of Member Costa's, Vice President Costa's concerns. So to my recollection, this whole process began a couple of years ago, when we made a presentation to the Board of Governors about the progress or lack of progress that the community college system had made in diversifying its faculty and classified staff. And I think at that meeting, the message was conveyed very clearly to the Chancellor's office that moving the needle on equal employment opportunity was of critical importance to the Board of Governors. And that is what led to the formation of the task force and a lot of the DEI work that you've heard about the Chancellor's office doing over the past couple of years. And that presentation to the board was a presentation of the data that had been adduced as a result of the EEO regulations that existed at the time. And the message was quite clear that the needle wasn't moving fast enough. And that we would all be retired or dead by the time we got to a place of an acceptable level of diversity among our faculty and classified staff, unless we took some stronger action. So I think the message from the board at that time was very clear that our EEO regulations were not pushing hard enough. And so what I think the committees have, the task force and the EEO DAC have done in recommending these changes is they're trying to push the system. But there is always this tension in regulating between the chancellor's office responsibility to be a regulatory and policy body over all of the community college districts, and at the same time respecting that the individual community college districts are independent and governed by their own governing boards. There's always a tension in what we do. We tried to strike that balance. I think that my view of the regulations is that they envision an iterative process between the board, the local board, the local board stakeholders, and yes, the chancellor's office has a potential role there, both in commenting before plans are provided to the district, but also if there is intransigence. And I do appreciate Member Costa's comment that, you know, we all believe in the good faith of the boards of trustees and that they want to move the needle on equal employment opportunity. And I think if there is progress and we see that local districts are evolving to respond to their unique circumstances, then there would be no cause for the chancellor's office to move to withhold funds. But it would be a very strange regulatory regime not to have any teeth behind it at all. And so I think that's where we have tried to strike the balance. I think that people who have contributed to these regulations have tried to be cognizant and respectful of local district governance. So I don't think that they're too heavy-handed, but obviously that ultimate determination is for this board to make.
So thank you for that. I'd like to bring the chancellor in before I take any other comments.
Thank you, Board President Haynes. And I just wanted to quickly speak to this both as the chancellor of the system and as a former superintendent president of a local district. There is a healthy tension that has to take place between the system office and the colleges. The reason we have this conversation is because there isn't enough movement and has not been enough movement for decades. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to lose sight of this because if left up to itself, the system would not and has not created the kind of diversity that we're looking for. So this conversation happened because of the data that's in front of not only the system office, but every district in the state. And so these recommendations aren't from Sacramento. Let me just be clear. I'm not quite sure what that means, but this is not Sacramento speaking. This is the chancellor's office speaking in partnership with the system and with the constituent groups that came together to propose these to the Board of Governors. So this is not just the chancellor's office recommendations. These are recommendations that have been deliberated and discussed amongst the various constituent groups, including the Academic Senate, to come up with a proposed regulation. So I do think it is a healthy balance. I do think that it should be within the discretion of the Board of Governors to withhold funds if it feels that progress is not being made. This doesn't mean that we will withhold funds every time a plan is not fully fulfilled, but it does give the discretion to the Board of Governors should there not be progress. So that's my point of view on this. I support the regulation. I do think it is a balance. It is not what perhaps I'd like to see done and perhaps what some college leaders feel is an overreach. I think it is a balance. And I would support it as a district CEO because it does give me the latitude to move a college forward on issues that are critically important to the state.
Thank you, Chancellor. I see Board Member Anderson and then Board Member Aguinaldo.
Thank you. Mark answered my questions. I would just say this, and it plays off of what the chancellor just said. I mean, it's not for, the districts that are already cooperating. And I think Kevin said you know, that there are those that feel overburdened with everything. And the reason that we have to have oversight is not for the good ones. It's for the bad ones that don't want to go along. And obviously, you know, based on what was said, my question was, how much work has gone on? Who collaborated on this? And it's very apparent that everyone collaborated. And I don't think after all the good work we've done with this program, we can't leave a few campuses behind. So I'm in support of the work that's been done by the coalition. And I'm support because I don't believe you can leave one or two campuses that may want to push back on this. And there needs to be some action for those bad operators that may not want to do as many of our board members' campuses are doing.
Thank you. Board Member Aguinaldo.
Thank you very much, President Haynes. I just wanted to start by saying how much I appreciate and acknowledge my colleagues' comments. I'm going to echo some things that General Counsel LaForestier said, which was that most of us would be retired or dead once we saw the kind of changes that we needed to attain. And that in fact is true. I know during the 2 years of work that we've spent on these DEI committees, that we actually pulled statistics out to show that if we were truly going to move the needle at the status quo pace, it would take many lifetimes to do so. So to me, it's absolutely unacceptable for us to stay at status quo. In order to make a change to that status quo, we need to do two things. One is to change hearts and minds, and the other one is to effectuate a policy change. I can tell you that as a person who has proximity to DEI on multiple industries, that it would be naive of us to think that everybody has great intentions and is willing to go along. But I do think that we as a chancellor's office and as a system leadership need to make sure that we are meeting folks where they are at. And that's exactly what this tool is intended to be. This EEO plan is an important tool to effectuate diversity, if not the most important tool. It is a transformative document. It is a tool of accountability, but we also need to know how to support people where they are. And that's exactly the type of dialogue that Board Member Rawlings had had mentioned earlier. So I'm in favor of this regulation. I'm in favor of our actions. I'm in favor of the multiple people I've been working with who commented on this regulation. And I think that a document like this will not only shape how we react during this time of social justice, but also really set a really clear path for what we expect of our system in the future. What we do now is really critical to making sure that our future reflects what we want it to. So I'm wholeheartedly in support of this, and I hope you guys are as well.
Thank you. Vice President Costa?
Yeah, just really quick, I wanna just divide the question based on some of the comments that people have provided. So I, you know, the plans in and of themselves, I certainly see the value of having them be measurable. And I think, you know, it gets to the point of moving the needle. I think what my issue though is the idea that an iterative process with the chancellor's office is going to move these recalcitrant districts. I don't buy that based on my 25 years of public policy experience. I believe in the plans. I believe in us providing support for the districts that want it. But the bad actors, you know, I don't see that this solves the moving the needle issue in my mind. I don't know what does. I'm open to those suggestions, but you know, we can't even say whether or not the previous withheld funds were related to this. So it's hard for me from a data perspective to know whether or not that is an effective lever in moving the districts that don't want to move. And maybe somebody can speak to it. You know, I have no way of knowing, like, is that one district? Is that two districts? Are most districts doing the right thing? I mean, I don't really know.
So before I take Board Member Williams, Chancellor, I want you to close out this particular item, but I'm gonna have Board Member Williams ask his question or make his comment, and then I want you to close this out on this one.
Yeah, I think a lot was said, and I agree that the work needs to continue to move forward, but listening to Member Hall's comment, is there a way And I'm thinking about integrated planning because, you know, as a trustee, we see a lot of plans. We see the triple SP plans. There's so many plans that come across. Is there tools or resources or ways or new innovative approaches that we could take to help districts with how they got to write some of this stuff? Because, like, you know, folks, I think, kind of get confused when you roll out frameworks versus programs. And all I see is a bunch of silos that kind of get created on the campus. And so how do we remove that part of it and to get at some of these things? Because the way some stuff is communicated, it can feel overwhelming to the folks that got to implement it. And so I'm just thinking about better integrated planning and better ways to communicate these big frameworks that come, because the EEO should be part of everything that they do. It shouldn't be seen as this separate project. You know, it should be part of guided pathways. It should be part of the vision for success. But the way that some of this stuff is communicated, it feels like a whole separate department and a whole separate thing by itself. And so just thinking about that, if there's something that we can help districts with, you know, I don't know if they'd appreciate it or not, but as a trustee, just seeing it, I just would like to see better integrated planning.
It's your turn, Chancellor.
Okay. Well, I do appreciate the various points of input. I do. I mean, obviously, I believe in subsidiarity. I think it's a hallmark of our system. It's what sets us apart from the other two systems of public higher education. And I think it's an important part of our DNA. But there are times where we want to see the system go. And we can, I think there is no perfect regulation. I mean, the whole nature of regulation is always challenging. But I do think it sends a message. And in this case, it is a message that was co-created by many members of the system that feel equally strong about the chancellor's office taking a role and the board of governors taking a role of sending the message. This is no different than the messaging around AB 705 or any of the other very important initiatives that we talk about that are part of the vision for success. This is part of the vision for success. This is a central part. We cannot have equity and outcomes, in my opinion, without improved diversity on our campuses. The two go hand in hand. There are certainly could be better ways of accomplishing that goal. But what we're trying to do, in my estimation, what we're asking the Board of Governors to do is to set a clear line. And maybe it's not clear to many of the board members, and it may not be clear. And certainly we will approach this in terms of wanting to continue to do more and better. At this point, this is the collective recommendation of those who have been serving on this task force. And I would support moving forward. I think if we see that this is not serving the goals and the vision for success, we will be the first to recommend that we take a different approach. At the end of the day, this is ultimately the role of the hiring authorities in the 73 districts. But I do think that as a system office, particularly since there are resources flowing from the state to the districts, that we do have a role in pointing out where we want to see the districts go and how we want to see these resources used.
Thank you, Chancellor. Board Member Hall, if you have a burning desire to comment, it should be short though. Oh, you're on mute.
I don't know if it's burning, it's just a desire, but I guess my issue is, I look at the existing Title V sections that we're amending as being already robust and progressive. But I guess you're saying that they're not, are you saying it's a failure, or we just need to do more? There are critical flaws within this Title V document that we're amending.
So.
Yeah, what I would say is, It is the recommendation of the Chancellor's Office in partnership with the DEI Task Force and the many representatives from throughout the system that the Title V regulations that previously existed were not enough. And so that is what we're saying. Now, perhaps there's a disagreement whether or not these revisions are the right revisions, but what we are clearly saying is that the previous regulations were not achieving the outcomes that we wanted to see.
Okay, thank you so much. This was a robust discussion among board members. Is there any public comment on this item?
The public comment period for item 4.2 is now open. Please use the raised hand feature. If you're calling into the meeting, use *9. A member of the Chancellor's Office will call on you and allow you to address the board. You will have a maximum of 3 minutes. We have not received any written comments on this item, and I will now turn it over to Gary for hands raised.
We do have several hands raised. And we'll start with Jesse Ryan. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
I do, thank you. Good afternoon, members of the board. Jesse Ryan, Executive Vice President of the Campaign for College Opportunity. I also am a member of the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Implementation Work Group. And I want to begin by thanking you all for such a thoughtful conversation. I also want to commend the Chancellor's Office for doing work that can be described as herding cats at times over the course of the last year plus to ensure that very disparate groups were coming together in a common vision for actualizing diversity, equity, and inclusion. I think it's important to note that, as Chancellor Oakley and others have said, we are embarking on this difficult work because the data has shown that colleges left on their own, irrespective of their stated commitments and values, have not been able to ensure that we have campuses whose faculty, both tenured and non, reflect the diversity of the students they serve. As you are well aware, in 2018, the Campaign for College Opportunity put out a groundbreaking report, Left Out, which found what I can only say is astonishing, that 71% of California's community colleges were led by academic senates that were white, that 62% of our tenured faculty were white, that 61% of our non-tenured faculty were white. Now, this is critical because, as we know, if we truly seek to actualize the vision for success, to ensure that Guided Pathways is successful, to do more than just say we're outraged by inequities that we see in the system every day, we have to double down on the mechanisms we have to ensure that we are in fact recruiting, retaining, and growing at every level of California community colleges leadership that reflects our student population. I know a discussion has come out about talking about whether or not funding is the right incentive. What I would say is that, as several board members have spoken to over the course of this spirited dialogue, funding has been shown to be a powerful incentive. In fact, we've seen that it's both accelerated and helps institutionalize this very important work. And I want to give time to other public commenters, but I just want to wrap up by saying that absolutely, this is just one in a set of tools that we hope will be utilized to ensure that diversity, equity, and inclusion is more than a catchphrase, but truly integrated in the fabric of everything community college campuses do. But this is a critical step that's time has come. So I urge your support of these EEO regulatory revisions. They are absolutely essential at this moment in time.
Thank you for your comments.
Next, we have Wendy Brill Wincoop. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Thank you. Good afternoon, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, Chancellor Oakley, and members of the Board of Governors. I'm Wendy Brill Wincoop, President president of the Faculty Association of the California Community Colleges. As a member of the DEI Implementation Workgroup, FAC supports the proposed regulatory action. Achieving our institutional diversity goals, including a more diverse faculty, requires intentional approaches at our colleges. This regulatory action will strengthen our EEO commitments and further move us in the direction of having all our colleges be diverse, equitable, and inclusive learning environments. We encourage the Board of Governors to adopt this regulatory proposal. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have Dr. Larry Galizio. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Thank you, Gary. President Haynes, Vice President Costa, members of the board, Chancellor Oakley, Larry Galizio, Community College, League of California. Thank you for having a really informative and important discussion on this issue, and agree with Chancellor Oakley. This tension always exists between the Board of Governors, the Chancellor's office, the legislature, and then the local districts and the locally elected trustees and those who have to implement all the regulations. And so I do have a question. I'm just going to state my question because some of our members had a specific question, but I'm going to state the question, but then I'm going to talk about other issues just because I don't have enough time, and hopefully the question will get answered. So on section 53003, subsection A, number 4, the second sentence says that comments received from the Chancellor's office on the proposed plan must be presented to the governing board prior to adoption. So the question that we've gotten from some of our member districts is, does presented mean it has to be orally read in a board meeting, or could it merely be written material to the members of the board? So that's the question. I hope we'll get answered at the end. So do appreciate the fact that the Chancellor's office worked with practitioner groups, those who actually have to implement these and other types of regulations. And I think that's absolutely essential. And we hope going forward, there are many well-intentioned groups that are non-practitioners that have never worked a day at a campus. And so we appreciate the fact that you have multiple practitioner groups and individuals working on this, on these types of important issues. First, and Chancellor Oakley will not be surprised with this, there's a diversity of viewpoints among the CEOs and the trustees on this particular item. I do appreciate the concerns about subsidiarity, and those are some of the concerns that we have heard. I think it's unfortunate when there's a claim that there are bad actors or that there are individuals or board members or others who do not support diversification.
30 seconds.
If there are, I think the Chancellor's Office, I think the Board of Governors, I think the League and many other organizations have done a phenomenal job of making the case intellectually with data and with strong argumentation that we have to do much better. And so do we want a coercive relationship, or do we want to empower and educate and continue to do this important work together? Thank you.
Thank you for your comment. That's time.
Thank you.
Next, we have Dolores Davison. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Good afternoon, Board President Haynes, Vice President Costa, Chancellor Oakley, and members of the Board of Governors. My name is Dolores Davison. I'm the president of the Academic Senate for California Community Colleges, as well as the co-chair of the EEO Advisory Committee at the Chancellor's Office. I'm deeply appreciative of this conversation that has been occurring this afternoon. I know that when I started on the EEO committee in my first stint back in 2016, believed that there was no way we would make any movement, and that the idea of having a change to EEO plans or a requirement around it would never work. I was proven wrong, and very happily proven wrong, that within 2 years, every district was in compliance with submitting EEO plans. There is a need for statewide leadership Board Member Hall referenced our modules. Those are suggested ideas around hiring, and they have come out of many years of requests from our districts for sample questions and ideas around how to improve hiring and how to improve hiring processes. So I'm grateful that you had an opportunity to look at them, and I'm happy to have anyone else do so as well. We need to allow these regulations to go through. As Chancellor Oakley mentioned, these have been vetted through a significant number of stakeholder groups, practitioner groups, the folks that are on the campus doing this work and trying to make these changes. And if they aren't as successful as we'd like them to do, then we make more changes and we continue to move the needle. But without this positive movement forward, we are going to stay mired in the current situation. We need to move the status quo, and we need to be bold as we do it. And so I urge that you pass these regulatory changes. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And that is all the public comment we have at this time.
I want to thank both the public and my colleagues for a very robust discussion. At this time, this is an action item, so I will entertain a motion and a second to approve.
Pam,
I'm sorry, hold on a second. Amy, you had something?
Yeah, I kind of want to propose a motion that I think kind of meets kind of the conversation that we had, which is, you know, my fear is I don't want us to adopt this and then never look back at whether or not it solved the issue. So what I would propose, and I would need a second, is for us to approve the regulations as drafted, but request that the chancellor's office come back to the board in 6 months to report out on the number of comments provided by the chancellor's office within the 90-day period as specified, the total amount of withheld funds and the number of districts impacted. And I defer to the counselor's office that the 6 month mark is the right one. It may be a year, I don't know. But I'd like a report back because I can be convinced, but I don't think we really have the data.
So I think 6 months is too short. We don't move in 6 months increments. So if you would be willing to amend that to at least a year, we may be able to get some data around that. And I heard you say you are. Okay. Somebody tell me what I now need to do in terms of an amendment.
Can we just clarify what we're asking the chancellor to come back with? What specifically is he supposed to come back with?
Amy, would you please enumerate?
Sure. That we would adopt the regulations as proposed, Board Member Williams, but that in 1 year, the chancellor's office will report back to the board on kind of the number of comments the chancellor's office provided within the 90-day period of time as specified in the regulations, the iterative process that our general counsel referred, the number of plans submitted, which according to Vice Chancellor Gonzalez, I think it's like a third, and the total amount of withheld funds and the number of districts impacted within that same period of time.
Mark, I'll let you explain the formalities around two different proposals. What I will clarify is this is a part of your DEI implementation integration plan that you adopted. We are required to already provide you a report every 6 months. Your next report will be at your next September board meeting. And then right after that, every 6 months, we have to provide you an implementation update. I'll also highlight that this is only step one. Our office is still required to put out guidance, a brand new template. It's going to take more than a year. And even then, our districts will not be implementing and submitting under a brand new template until, what do we think, Mark? Late fall of 2022, or is it 2023?
Mark. I can jump in there.
Probably late fall 2022, early 2023. The other element here is that our regulations don't actually take effect until they go through the process of approval by the Department of Finance. So, and filing with the Secretary of State. So sometimes that takes a few months. It's hard to predict. So if I think the commitment to return within a, I appreciate the flexibility on a year, but I think it should be a year from implementation of the regulation. Does that make sense?
Yes, I'm assuming this is considered a major reg, STD 699.
Yes.
Okay.
So Vice President Costa, would you trust that from the commitment of the Deputy Chancellor and our legal counsel that when it is absolutely feasible, having stepped through the regulation process and the approval process, that they're going to come back, as I understood from Deputy Chancellor Gonzalez, they're going to be coming back in about 6 months on some parts of the issue, and then subsequently after that. And it'll be an opportunity for any one of us to be asking questions on progress.
Yeah, that's fine. And I certainly understand the timing issue that they each raised. So I think, upon implementation is appropriate.
Thank you so much. So with that in mind, do you still wish to have an amendment to it? Or are you willing to withdraw your concerns and let this process go through? What's your pleasure?
I'd still like the report back as part of the formal motion, but I don't necessarily have a second, so I may not get that wish.
All right, so then let's play this all the way out. Does our Vice President get a second on this?
I will second the motion.
Okie dokie. So please walk me through. So we have a motion and we have a second to have at least a report back within a year. We're going to get something back in 6 months, but a much more formalized report back in about a year. Is that correct?
So I think let's not bring in what Deputy Chancellor Gonzalez is reporting back.
Okay.
6 months. Let's just keep it to the regulations. So I think the motion is to approve the regulations as proposed by the Chancellor's office and to direct the Chancellor's staff to report back to the board within a year from the effective date of the regulations on progress.
With that stated.
But Mark, don't you have to go ahead and vote on them separately?
So that would be the motion. That would be the motion that would be before the board. Or do you want to have right? So that's another thing. You could have a vote on the pending motion, which is just to approve the regulations.
Well, but there was never a motion actually called.
That's right.
So the floor. We have a motion for Amy's change. We have to vote that up or down. And then I think we have to go back unless she adds it into the language.
No, we don't want
to add it. My motion is to accept the proposed regulations and the reporting requirement. So you are correct. We have to vote that up or down, but it would encapsulate approval of the regulations.
But I don't think you can bind us in the second vote.
You can't.
So another approach would be to approve the regulations up or down.
Yes.
And then have a second vote on a motion to direct the Chancellor's office to report back within 1 year from implementation.
Correct. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. If I could just add, not to make this even more complicated, but the board president can direct the Chancellor to come back with a report regardless of a motion. So
I can so direct if I can get my Vice President to agree.
If you will do it, President Haynes, I would gladly take that and I will withdraw the motion on the floor.
Thank you. I direct the Chancellor's office to report back after implementation and to give us a report within a year of implementation.
That was going to happen anyway, right? I'm sure we're going to ask the Chancellor to report back to us on the progress of this at some point anyway.
But now we've directed him to do him or her to
we
do
have a formal yeah
in a very formal way, with that, then can I get a
motion? I move
on the regulations.
I move on the regulation.
Okay. I'll second.
We have a motion by Member Anderson, and then can I hear a second?
Second from Rawlings.
Second from Rawlings. And would you please take the roll?
Yes. Hildegard B. Aguinaldo.
Aye.
Darius W. Anderson.
Aye.
Amy M. Costa.
Aye.
Tom Epstein.
Aye.
Felicia Escobar Carrillo.
Aye.
Jolina M. Grande.
Aye.
Pamela Haynes.
Aye.
Kevin J. Hall.
No.
Lieutenant Governor Eleni Kunalekis.
Aye.
Bill Rawlings.
Aye.
Valerie L. Shaw.
Aye.
Yulia Tarasova.
Aye.
Joseph R. Williams.
Aye.
President Haynes, the motion carries.
Thank you. I want to do at this point, thank you so much. This was a very important conversation. I want to do a time check and then I want to get the sense of the board. It's now 3:29, 3:30. And we've got four items to get through. So the last time I said, let's take a break, y'all didn't do it in 5 minutes. So I'm not going to release you in that way this time, but if you need to take a break, then please do so. Because I would like to get through the next three items so we can get you out of here at a reasonable time. So if you do have to sort of remove yourself temporarily, and I know I will call on my vice president to back me. I'd like to go to item 4.3, which is the revision of Title 5, 55063. It's the minimum requirement for associate degree. The ethnic studies, and this is the second reading, which means it's up for approval. We have Vice Chancellor Lowe as the presenter.
Thank you very much, Board President Haynes. Good afternoon, everyone. Aisha Lowe, Vice Chancellor of Educational Services and Support. For the sake of time, I will move through this item expeditiously. As Board President Haynes just mentioned, this is coming before you as second read. We are recommending approval of this revision to the regulations. As Board President Haynes said, Title 5, 55063, minimum requirements for the associate degree, adding an ethnic studies course as a requirement. I will not belabor rehashing all of the background here, as you saw detailed in the digest. This comes before you with high support from across our field. The Academic Senate, the Statewide Student Senate, as well as our Ethnic Studies Faculty Council. This is in alignment with the work that is moving forward with the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Integration Plan, the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Call to Action, as well as some of the goals for our Equity with Recovery Report that came out of the Governor's Office, and is in alignment with the work that is already moving forward across our system to implement ethnic studies as a part of the new CSU General Education Area F requirement. What you'll see before you in the slides, next slide, please, I will really hone in on what the next steps would be if the Board of Governors does decide to approve today, which is really around implementation. Our next immediate step would be to establish a short-term ethnic studies task force to engage in the host of activities you see listed here. This task force will be created in collaboration with the Academic Senate, the Student Senate, as well as the Ethnic Studies Faculty Council, so that we can engage the various constituent groups from across the field on implementation, gathering information as needed from the field, defining ethnic studies for our system, making necessary updates to not only the PACA, but other processes and procedures across our system. Very importantly, collaborating on professional development so that we can ensure that ethnic studies is implemented with fidelity, that being one of many places where we will coordinate with our counterparts at CSU, as we are already doing, as we're working through course approvals within CSU now, as well as evaluating implementation. Next slide, please. Additionally, there are some efforts that are already underway that really take place through already established processes across our system. Faculty are already working together on establishing an ethnic studies transfer model curriculum, establishing the needed CID course descriptors, And also looking into the minimum qualifications for ethnic studies faculty and examining what, if any, updates are needed there. Last slide then. There was a question during first read around what local implementation will look like. So it is very common across our field for establishing new courses, new requirements, new programs, and a host of activities that districts and colleges that engage in locally when those changes are made. So of course, local policies will need to be updated. Local general education patterns would then be updated. I do think it's important to note here that currently within our regulations, we require a minimum of 18 units, again, a minimum of 18 units for the associate degree. We had previously defined what 15 of those 18 are specifically. This new requirement will fill out the remaining 3 units of that 18. But locally, what is required for an associate degree does vary across our districts and colleges. So locally, districts and colleges will have to engage in that work of the changes they're going to make within their patterns. New courses and programs may be established, additional faculty hired as needed, lots of updates to systems and documents, and of course, an important focus on advising as well as informing students of this change and how they must then navigate that change. I will stop there to take any questions or comments. And again, our recommendation is for approval of this revision to our regulations.
Thank you for that presentation. Are there questions from our Board of Governors members? I see one hand. Member Escobar Carrillo.
Hi there. Thanks so much. I wasn't here with the first reading of this. I just want to, you know, as an ethnic studies graduate myself and someone that helped my college establish our ethnic studies program, I'm really excited to see the work that you all are doing here on this, and particularly the coordination with CSU, I think is really important because we want to make sure that to the extent possible that this course work could count towards to transfer courses. I know I read in some of the comments that there was a concern around, why should we be doing this? Shouldn't CSU be doing this? And to me, it speaks to just the seamlessness and the importance of the seamlessness from our students' experiences on our campuses, as they consider transferring to other places. Is there conversations with the UCs at all about this? I'm curious about that. Just because the CSU was collaboration or coordination seems to be called out specifically, but I'm not sure how the discussions are going with the UC system.
Thank you for that question. Yes, those conversations are underway as well. UC is still at the process with their faculty of fully codifying and approving how they are going to change the IGETC pattern to align with the CSU requirement around ethnic studies. So what we will see if we approve this change is really, as you were saying, Member Carrillo, that seamless alignment across all 3 systems in supporting this particular requirement.
Great, thanks.
Other questions? So I actually have a question, and it goes to, do you have any idea how this will be reflected, this approval will be reflected on our campuses? There are many campuses that don't have an ethnic studies department. Can it be a standalone, and can it be housed in another department, social sciences or some other? And can there be, we call it ethnic studies, but can it be, there were some students that indicated some other pathways to get some of this information. Is the curriculum going to be designed in a way that it can't be housed anyplace else, and you have to step through all of these different steps in the curriculum? I know that's a lot of questions in one. I apologize.
Well, let me do my best to address that question, President Haynes. So the short answer is yes. What's codified in this revision, very similar to what we have in that same section of regulations around some of our other courses, is that this requirement can be satisfied through taking an ethnic studies course that is taught in or on behalf of other departments and disciplines. So our implementation will look similar to what we've seen happen even as CSU has been implementing that ability for cross-listing of courses, that ability to have the ethnic studies course also apply to a social science requirement or a humanities requirement, also again towards that goal of ensuring that the requirements for our students in terms of the number of units that they must complete is not negatively impacted. So that cross-listing across different departments and discipline will be a part of the process.
I appreciate that, thank you. I see a hand raised for Board Member Tarasova.
Thank you, President Haynes. This is very exciting item on today's action calendar for a lot of students. There was an astonishing amount of support from the students before in support of ethnic studies. And I was there when the Student Senate has passed a resolution advocating for ethnic studies graduation requirement this past spring. And my question would be around effective date of the implementation. So which cohort of students would be affected of it? With the changes proposed if passed, as well as I've seen some language on this being as alleviating the stress on the system. And at the same time, it is a different conversation when we're talking about the student experience and instruction, if it is a definite requirement for a student to transfer out of community college to CSU. So I wanted just to clarify that, whether the student has to take this class in order to transfer out to CSU.
Thank you for that. I will address both of those questions. I'll start with the CSU question. So yes, right, CSU per the legislation that came for their system has implemented in ethnic studies course as this new area F for the general education requirements for transferring into the California State University system. So when I mentioned earlier that in us instituting this requirement, we really are aligning with work our campuses are already doing. That's exactly what I was referring to. Our campuses are already increasing classes, developing new classes, because there is already basically a de facto requirement for our system as we continue to collaborate and align with the requirements of CSU. And as I just mentioned, we're expecting to see similar changes come out of UC in the IGETC pattern as well. And so certainly within our regulations, that's also why we have that very important line in this revision around a transfer level course so that we are not duplicating efforts or creating different pathways. These courses will be transfer level courses aligned to the requirements for transfer into CSU and UC as our colleges are already working on those. I've received lots of questions about implementation dates. I will not dare unilaterally make that decision right now in a public forum, but we'll say that that will be an important part of the discussion with the Ethnic Studies Task Force that will be developed to really think through what would be the appropriate implementation date. I would say my recommendation as one of the individuals who has been helping to lead this work is that we would look towards a fall of 2023. Looking at the very real realities of what our colleges are facing right now, still recovering from the impacts of the pandemic, looking at the very real realities that our colleges are still working now just to meet that new CSU requirement and get courses approved through the CSU system and wanting to have all of those in place this fall and forthcoming. So that's a potential date that we might look at. Fall of 2022 would certainly be the earliest, with fall of 2023 being a recommendation that we might start with.
Thank you for the clarification. I really appreciate it because I know we're trying not to duplicate the efforts, especially since we're trying to have our students to have the lowest amount of units before they transfer out or get their degree. And it's been a complicated path for a lot of students to do that. And lastly, I would like to express if there is an opportunity, I'm really interested in joining the next conversations around the ethnic studies requirements. As I understand, there's going to be a short-term workforce form later on.
Well, thank you for that. I'll take note of that and work with our Deputy Chancellor on that. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't see any other hands up. So I'm going to ask if there's any public comment.
The public comment period for item 4.3 is now open. Please use the raise hand feature. If you are calling into the meeting, use star 9. A member of the chancellor's office will call on you and allow you to address the board. You'll have a maximum of 3 minutes. We have not received any written comments on this item, and I will now turn it over to Gary for any hands raised.
We have several hands raised. Let's start with Belinda Lum. You have control of your microphone and can address the board.
Good afternoon, President Haynes and Board of Governors. My name is Dr. Belinda Lum from Sacramento City College in the Los Rios Community College District. I want to speak in strong support of this item. This is the moment where I believe the Board of Governors has an opportunity to be a game changer in terms of adopting this requirement for a number of reasons. We've talked a lot about diversity and equity and inclusion with the recent with the EEO discussion earlier. And I would say that as someone who is a professor because of ethnic studies, because I saw myself in the books of an Asian American studies class, that I know the power that this curriculum has. In addition, I also want to note that we would never ever ask, as a sociologist or an ethnic studies practitioner, I would never ever presume to ask to tell biology how to implement biology and what that curriculum should look like. And as a result, I would also tell you that ethnic studies is a discipline that should be housed in an ethnic studies program. That when we talk about cross-listing, it should absolutely be taught by someone with minimum qualifications in the field of ethnic studies. It is interdisciplinary by nature, and one of the most important parts of the work that Dr. Lowe's group has indicated as part of this work is defining ethnic studies. And as a member of the council, the California Community College Ethnic Studies Faculty Council, we wholeheartedly support working on that with you. And so I really want to encourage that the work we do today is really about making sure that every student that comes through these California Community Colleges has an opportunity to see themselves in the curriculum, to see themselves and their experiences reflected in the work that they do. And that we also, I think it's equally important, move away from a zero-sum game. That a lot of the talk around ethnic studies is that in order to make ethnic studies happen, there has to be a loss elsewhere. We know that this is an opportunity for everyone to be educated and to grow. So I thank you for the time to make comment. I wholeheartedly support this. And I also especially support the making sure that we have resources available to all campuses to make this happen in a robust and meaningful way. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next, we have Dolores Davison. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Thank you. Good afternoon again, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, Chancellor Oakley, and members of the Board of Governors, Dolores Davison, President of the Academic Senate for California Community Colleges. One of the charges that is often leveled against our system is how slowly we move when we are trying to do things. And I find that this ethnic studies requirement goes against that notion and against the idea that we don't move quickly. In fact, we recently passed in the fall of 2020 a resolution through the Academic Senate asking for the creation of this graduation requirement. And here we are at the Board of Governors looking at approving it. And that is remarkable and momentous for our system. I don't think that can be overstated. I want to thank, on behalf of the Academic Senate for California Community Colleges, the Chancellor's Office, and particularly Vice Chancellor Dr. Aisha Lowe for her partnership in this. I would like to very much thank the Ethnic Studies Faculty Council, who have been wonderful. Dr. Lum and all of the other members of the council have been terrific to work with, and we look forward to working with them on the task force over the summer. And I want to give a special shout out to our members on 5C, which is the statewide curriculum committee. They formed a task force comprised primarily of faculty to look at this issue and to determine the best course of action for it. They worked tirelessly through the fall into the spring, and the result is much of what you see here. And so we are indebted to them and honored by the work that they have done. And I urge that you approve this regulatory change. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Wendy Brill-Winecoop. You have control of your microphone and can address the board.
Good afternoon, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, Chancellor Oakley, and members of the Board of Governors. I'm Wendy Brill-Winecoop, President of the Faculty Association of the California Community Colleges. The FAC Board of Governors voted to support these Title V revisions to expand our curriculum to include an ethnic studies requirement for the associate's degree. We see this as an important step in DEI work and making our system more culturally responsive to our students. We are grateful for the leadership of the ASCCC in leading the way in these revisions. We'd also like to acknowledge that all system practitioners are in alignment with this necessary and important work. DEI must be at the forefront of all our respective organizations' work. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, we have Melissa Moreno. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Yes, good afternoon, California Community College leaders. I am Melissa Moreno. I'm an ethnic studies faculty in the community college system. I'm also the co-chair of the California Community College Ethnic Studies Council. And it is with great gratitude that the council stands with students and faculty in our leadership in making this happen. Ethnic studies, as you know, is 50 years old. And so we are prepared. We have been waiting for this day to be able to share a culturally relevant curriculum with students. I myself am a first generation college student. Even though my family has been here for over 500 years, it was ethnic studies that facilitated the pathway for me. And so the Community College Ethnic Studies Faculty Council is prepared to collaborate with the Chancellor's Office, as well as continuing to collaborate with our CSU Ethnic Studies colleagues and leadership in this authentic implementation. It is so important to keep at the forefront the importance of having ethnic studies be taught with faculty who are trained in ethnic studies specifically, and being able to offer professional development opportunities for our faculty across the system. Again, thank you for supporting this item.
Thank you.
Next, we have Carlos R. Guerrero. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Carlos Guerrero. Thank you for opening up the mic for us to present our wishes of this implementation. I'm also co-chair of the California Community College Ethnic Studies Faculty Council. And I come to you from Los Angeles City College, where I've taught for over 20 years, and I've taught in higher ed and ethnic studies for almost 30 years. And I can tell you that as we talk about the implementation of this, I've been at the forefront of our courses in ethnic studies and Chicano studies in my case, and I've seen the difference that it makes in our students. It's a pathway. We've had students who come through our classes and give a bigger sense of who they are and a sense of belonging to a larger American community. Some of our students will, you know, I had a student who was in my ethnic studies classes. He eventually became a dentist, went to USC Dental School, and part of, you know, is realizing that he's part of his larger community. And I think that's one of the big things about the ethnic studies courses throughout the years. You heard Dr. Melinda Lum about seeing herself in the literature. And I had the same way. I was an engineering major before I went to ethnic studies. And I went all the way through and have been a college professor for almost 30 years in ethnic studies. And this is, for me, this is a great opportunity for us to no longer be in the shadows, but be at the forefront. So I support this implementation and I really appreciate your support.
Thank you.
We have no more hands raised, and we can conclude public comment.
Thank you for that. If there's no more discussion by the board, I'd like to entertain a motion to approve.
I'll move to approve. Rawlings.
Rawlings moves. And Aguinaldo seconds. So can I get a roll call vote, please?
Hildegard B. Aguinaldo.
Aye.
Darius W. Anderson.
Aye.
Amy M. Costa.
Aye.
Tom Epstein.
Aye.
Felicia Escobar Carrillo.
Aye.
Jolina M. Grande.
Aye.
Pamela Haynes.
Aye.
Kevin J. Hall.
Aye.
Lieutenant Governor Eleni Kunalakis.
Aye.
Bill Rawlings.
Aye.
Valerie L. Shaw.
Aye.
Yulia Tarasova.
Aye.
Joseph R. Williams.
Aye.
President Haynes, the motion carries.
Thank you so much. We are now in our first readings. We have two of them. The first one is the proposed revisions of Title V distance education. And I guess what I need to, and it's going to be presented by Vice Chancellor. Oh, sorry. It's going to be presented by General Counsel LaForest DA. And I do have to open this up as a public meeting. So let me read from my script, please. Item 5.1, a first reading and public hearing for proposed amendments to Title V of the California Code of Regulations, amending Section 55200, 55204, 55206, and 55208 related to distance education within the California Community Colleges. The item will be, as I said, will be presented by Chancellor Office staff. After the item is presented, I will bang forward a public hearing on this. So we're going to have General Counsel LaForest DA present. Thank you.
President Haynes, this is actually Vice Chancellor Ron O'Shaughnessy's item. I've got the next one.
Oh, I apologize. You're absolutely right. I'm so sorry. Vice President Ron O'Shaughnessy, would you please present on this item? So sorry.
No problem. Thank you. Good afternoon, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, Chancellor Oakley, and members of the board. I'm Rebecca Ron O'Shaughnessy, Vice Chancellor for Educational Services and Support. This item in front of you for first reading is the proposed revisions to the relevant Title V regulations relating to distance education. The revision language has been approved by the Office of General Counsel, and we have engaged and solicited and received feedback and advice from DTAC, 5C, TTAC, Student Senate, and the Academic Senate. You can find more details, including the actual revision language, in the digest. To provide context, this is part of the system's effort to transform distance education from playing a limited and supplemental role to the brick and mortar environment and serving only some students to becoming a real and sometimes preferred educational option for all. At the March meeting, in the context of proposing changes to Standing Order 409 on distance education, Lisa Beach, the chair of DTAC, highlighted the importance of that transformation because of the growing demand for distance education from the students, the potential of distance education to support instructional continuity and system resilience as evidenced by the pandemic. And most importantly, quality distance education can be a powerful equity tool to ensure educational access, experience, and success by leveraging technology and the convenience of place, time, and learning pace. Policy and regulatory actions is an important way for us to engage in that transformation. So in the coming year, we'll be digging into regulations impacting distance education in a comprehensive way, focusing on equity, quality, and innovations. This item is the first step into that effort. Next slide, please. The proposed revisions fall into two areas. The first area of the proposed revisions is about aligning Title V language with federal distance education regulations, including the changes that took effect on July 1. The proposed provisions do not fundamentally change how we have been offering distance education. The impacted four Title V sections are specified here on the slide under the first arrow. The key revisions include updating the definition of distance education to provide more specificity, changing the requirement of instructor and student contact from the term regular effective contact to the term regular and substantive interaction, and adding definitions for that definition. Third is to add to the criteria for instructor who deliver instructions via distance education to include the requirement of meeting qualifications established by accrediting agency. Again, those are simply to bring our existing language into alignment with federal regulations. The second area of the proposed revision impacts section 55005, and it's something that has been advocated by the students and proposed by DTAC. The goal is to provide students with more information relating to class expectations and technical requirements in distance education prior to their enrollment, so then they can make better informed decisions in terms of whether to enroll in that class and also be better prepared for classes in advance. Specifically, it will require the disclosure of whether the course is offered in a distance education format. And if so, the required disclosure will include details such as all the synchronous meeting dates and times, any required asynchronous in-person activities, required technology, as well as whether or not proctoring requirements are going to be part of the test or assessment. This item went to the Consultation Council on June 17th. Subsequently, the 45-day public comment period began on June 22nd. The questions and comments from the Consultation Council and from the public so far have been mostly for additional clarifications and local implementations. So all of these comments and questions highlighted the importance for us to issue guidance and memos, guidance memos to provide system and local level professional development and other scaffolding activities to ensure high quality accessibility, engagement and equity minded distance education experience for our students. We're taking notes, collecting these questions, and we'll closely partner with our participatory governance committees as well as other stakeholders to think through these questions and as well as other emerging issues. Again, this is just beginning of our work. We anticipate bringing additional proposals to you relating to distance education in the future. This concludes my presentation, and I'm happy to take any questions and comments you have. Thank you.
The public hearing on item 5.1, the proposed amendments to the California Code of Regulations, Title V, Section 55200, 55204, 55206, and 55208 is now open. The purpose of the hearing is for the Board of Governors to receive comments and testimony from members of the public regarding the proposed regulatory action. At this time, the floor is open for comments from the public. Are there any comments?
Yes. Currently, we have a few hands up. Let's start with Eric Kalumagi. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Okay, thank you, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, Chancellor Oakley. My name is Eric Kalumagi. I'm the president of the Community College Association, which is the higher ed community college affiliate of the California Teachers Association. For the most part, these revisions to Title V seem to be within the authority of the Academic Senate, but two items do give me pause. First of all, in Section 55204, there is the line that says, monitoring the student's academic engagement and success and ensuring that an instructor is responsible for promptly and proactively engaging in substantive interaction with the student. It is not always possible to promptly and proactively engage in substantive interaction with the student. Such requires that you can contact the student and that the student is willing to talk to you. I recommend that this language be altered to be something within an instructor's actual capabilities. Also, in Section 55208, we note that instructors of course sections delivered via distance education have to meet the qualifications for instruction established by an institution's accrediting agency. ACCJC has no specified requirements, as far as I can tell. DAC does, but that group covers only CalBright. I would think we would want distance and non-distance minimum qualifications to be the same. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the comments. So let me go to 5520A first around the criteria, adding the accredited agency qualification for instructions. This is really to bring in compliance, bring in alliance with a federal regulation. And you're correct that currently there's no specific qualifications for distance education in terms of from ACCJC, but this is really to establish that minimum qualification. And this does not prohibit take away the college or district's determination of ensuring their instructor are prepared to teach in the distance education method. So this is really kind of to establish that general minimum requirements to be compliant with the federal regulations. In terms of second comment around 55204, thank you for that. We'll take that back into advisement. I think a key consideration is really think about the intent of the regulation is to create that engaging experience for the students. And there are many ways, there are activities around academic engagements that we can continue to track around interactive tutorials and webinars, and how do we think about all the innovative methods that we can kind of deploy within our toolbox to really ensure that experience, and understanding that we can't guarantee, right, the fundamental outcome and some part of the experience have to come from the efforts of the students, but also really get to the root cause of a lot of the issues to see whether or not there are things as a system we can do, not just from the faculty perspective, but also get to kind of the support system that the community colleges can provide for these students to get them prepared to engage in a meaningful educational experience.
We do have another public comment. Rick Scuderi, you have control of your mic and can address the board.
Greetings, Chancellor Oakley and the Board of Governors, and thank you so much for the opportunity to speak before you. I'm Dr. Rick Scuderi, past president of the California Association of Postsecondary Education and Disabilities, and its former legislative chairperson. I'm speaking to you here, though, as an individual person, not representing that organization. It's ironic that the first thing to be done in these proposed state distance education guidelines is finding a legal reason to eliminate all references to federal laws ensuring equity and inclusion of distance education to students with disabilities. I'm speaking of the American with Disabilities Act and several sections of that, and the Section 508 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973 as amended. The students with disabilities are the one marginalized group so critically affected by distance education accessibility. Some educators do not know about these federal laws, and it is unclear that colleges are compliant with them and the oversight of content offered. In addition, the system itself could be liable since this is a system-wide document and breaches of these laws of accessibility are easily visible through social media. Case in point, a recent district distance education classroom incident gone viral on YouTube portraying a math science professor's contentious interaction with a student who was deaf. The student was trying to explain that she could not access his spoken words because the math science jargon could not be captioned properly. A short while later, on the viral feedback, the whole nation could see that the student's computer screen was at that time filled with captioned nonsense. However, the professor could not access the student's screen to understand what she was talking about, and was openly perturbed at the online class interruption. These problems of reasonable accommodations for students with disability are often difficult. They take extra time, effort, and money to rectify. And there's still no guarantee that a complete solution will be reached. But if these serious challenges are not faced openly with clarity, vigor, and resources, the results are nationally viral instances such as the above. A laissez-faire, hands-off attitude for online accessibility for students with disability may have worked in the past, but with social media becoming so prevalent and lack of compliance easily recorded and visible, time is running out on this gamble. Please reinstate the federal laws into the Chancellor's Office guidelines. They only take up one sentence.
Thank you.
And they serve as a reminder that the federal teeth are behind the state guidelines for distance education. Thank you.
We have no other hands raised at this time, so we can conclude public comment.
Thank you for that. I must ask again though, are there any additional members of the public who would like to speak on this matter? And if there are none, then this public hearing is closed.
Correct, there are none.
That's my gavel. So I now want to open this up to my colleagues on the board if they have questions. Doesn't look like there are any. This is a first reading, and it will come back to us at a later board meeting. With that, we are at item 5.2, another first reading. This is an amendment of the board standing order adding section 417 transfer agreements. And we have Executive Vice Chancellor Alvarado, but we also have General Counsel LaForce DA is the initial presenter.
Correct. Thank you, President Haynes. So the board standing orders are amended proceeding in two steps, much like the regulations, but with a slightly different process. So today, what we're doing is giving notice that the Chancellor's Office would like the board to amend its standing orders, and then the actual standing order amendment would occur at the next board meeting. This amendment would add a new section to the standing orders directing the Chancellor to take action with respect to transfer agreements. So for a number of years, the Chancellor been authorized, encouraged by the board to enter into a transfer agreement with other agreements with other institutions of higher education. At first, that was with UC and other public institutions. And then in 2019, we started negotiations with AICCU institutions. And at that time, the Chancellor's Office determined that it would be appropriate to include in the transfer agreements non-discrimination language that is similar to the language that is included in the board item. Recently, within the last few weeks, the United States Supreme Court issued a decision involving Catholic Social Services and a program operated by the City of Philadelphia. And in that case, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that a contract requiring a non-discrimination provision infringed upon the Catholic institution's free exercise rights. One of the factors that the court looked at in that case was that there was not a rule of general applicability that required the City of Philadelphia to impose that requirement upon Catholic Social Services. And so what we're bringing this forward today is to establish that rule of general applicability. We do believe that we have an obligation to provide equal access to our students for the benefits of the educational benefits that we provide to them, included the promotion of transfer opportunities to all institutions. And it is our view that the board ought to create a rule that any institution that will engage in a transfer agreement with the chancellor's office should commit to the non-discrimination language that we've outlined in this proposed standing order. So that is the proposal in a nutshell, and I'd be happy to take any questions that board members may have about this.
So I'd like to hear from board members if you have questions. I see board member Grande with her hand up, and then Vice President Costa.
Thank you very much, President Haynes. I'm looking at the actual language that's being proposed, and if I understand the agenda item correctly, it's primarily geared towards our students who are transferring from the community college to another institution. And if that is the case, I'm trying to understand the indented paragraph that begins with institution acknowledges that all students have a right to participate fully in community college educational processes. And I'm wondering if that's an appropriate statement if we're considering that they would be transferring to a different institution, primarily not a community college.
So the institution there would be the name of the college to which our students would be transferring. So what we are saying is that in a transfer agreement, we are expecting the transfer institutions to adopt non-discrimination language in the transfer agreement.
Okay, so let me try this. I'm going to substitute UCLA. Let's just say that that's our transfer institution. And I substitute that for the block that says institution. And it would now read, UCLA acknowledges that all students have a right to participate fully in community college educational processes. Would that be an appropriate statement that we're trying to read?
Well, we are trying to have the transfer institutions acknowledge that they have a responsibility to provide educational services in a non-discriminatory fashion.
So, Member Grande, if you think about it this way, a receiving institution may discriminate against a community college student for having participated in activities that are perfectly allowable in a community college. So we want to make sure, as our general counsel mentioned, that the receiving institution acknowledges that our students have the right to participate in any activity in a community college, and they shall not be discriminated against.
Thank you for the clarification. I appreciate it.
We have Lieutenant Governor Kunalakis.
I think that Vice Chair Costa had her hand up first.
Okay. Oh, but she's deferring to you, Lieutenant Governor.
Oh. So I'm wondering, Eloy, if you could put this in the context of the vote that we just took at the Regents that would prohibit the UC from entering into agreements that discriminate, and frankly, whether or not this is redundant as a result of the vote that was just taken. And then secondly, are there any unintended consequences of transfer into non-University of California or CSU, institutions that are not public institutions in the state of California, but, you know, say a student is interested in transferring to a school somewhere in another part of the country that might be a religious-based school, would we be inhibiting the ability of a student to exercise their choice of going to, say, a religious-based institution of higher learning somewhere in California or elsewhere? So those two questions.
So I will let the general counsel get into the details, but this is not necessarily an issue with UC or CSU because we all practice the same non-discrimination practices. So we all the public institutions do not discriminate against students entering any of our institutions based on any preference or activity that they demonstrate. The issue is with institutions that do have other requirements, and some of them may be religious requirements. So we want the institution to acknowledge that they cannot discriminate against one of our students because of a particular background characteristic or activities that they participate in. Now, this doesn't preclude a student to transfer to an institution that that does have a religious requirements. We're trying to prevent institutions from discriminating against our students. And I'll let the general counsel get into the specifics.
Right. So we have had conversations with a couple of religious institutions who are interested in entering into a transfer agreement. But the existence of this non-discrimination language was the sticking point. I don't want to get into the details of which institutions those were at this point, but that was an issue for them. Our view is that the Constitution requires us to take on an affirmative duty to avoid discrimination against our students. So if we are going to, and this is the benefit of the transfer agreement, we are promoting the transfer institution to our students, encouraging them to apply. But we really only feel that we can provide that promotion if all of the two institutions that have committed to the non-discrimination principle. So to the extent that a college chooses not to agree to this non-discrimination principle, they are still able to reach out to our students and advertise and accept them on a transfer basis if they choose to. But they would not be getting the benefit of our promotion of their school to our students.
Can I just ask a quick follow-up? Because the way that you're talking about it, I'm having a very hard time understanding where a circumstance might apply that taking this action would be essentially more than symbolic, where it would or could have a real impact. And if you could even just give an example of a real impact that this would have beyond the important message that certainly we don't want to enter into agreements where an institution would discriminate against our students. But is there something beyond what would be already prohibited under state or federal law?
So I'll point to the case involving Catholic Social Services and the city of Philadelphia. The Catholic Social Services, the purpose of that contract was to allow Catholic Social Services to certify foster parents to accept foster youth. Catholic Social Services would certify individual gay and lesbian parents, but would not certify gay and lesbian couples because they did not view that as an appropriate placement for foster children. The city of Philadelphia wanted to insist that as a condition of contracting with Catholic Social Services, they agreed to make placements and certify gay and lesbian couples. And the court said that contract was an infringement upon Catholic Social Services' free exercise of religion. What was important in that decision, potentially important in that decision and in other circumstances, is that the city of Philadelphia may have had discretion about whether to impose that requirement on Catholic Social Services or whether it was just a sort of a negotiation point, because the city of Philadelphia did not have a rule that it pointed to that said, in all instances, we will require this non-discrimination principle from all of the entities that we contract with to certify foster parents. The importance of having a rule of general applicability is that the legal standard that would apply in a challenge will be lower if there is no discretion and the rule of general applicability. If the chancellor or the city of Philadelphia in that case is deemed to have discretion, then strict scrutiny applies. And that that is creates a serious legal vulnerability for a public agency when they're subject to strict scrutiny. So in our instance, well, I do believe that there are a number of ways to distinguish our program of transfer agreements from the Catholic Social Services case. I want, in sort of a belt and suspenders way, to ensure that we have a clear rule, and so that in the event of a challenge to our program, we will not be subject to strict scrutiny. That is the real life purpose of this change.
Okay, but we don't, just a quick thought, we don't engage in that particular kind of contract that you cited in the Philadelphia case. Can you imagine a kind of activity that we do engage in where this would come up at all?
Well, we have.
And that's my last question, right. But I do appreciate the background.
Sure. So and I'm not sure it's a perfect analog, but we have with this transfer agreement system that we are engaged in, or process that we're engaged in, where we are contracting with multiple institutions of higher learning, where we are insisting on having non-discrimination language, has been objected to by a couple of religious institutions. So what I would not want is for some of the language in the Supreme Court's case to encourage litigation against the community colleges. And in the context of a US Supreme Court that appears to be very interested in expanding the scope of the free exercise clause in the Philadelphia case that I've mentioned, we can think about the infamous wedding cake case, the Hobby Lobby case. There is a trajectory, and I think that we should try to be as careful as we can so that we don't get embroiled in those kinds of disputes.
I really appreciate that explanation. That sounds a little more than belt and suspenders. So thank you very much for bringing this forward.
Thank you. We're gonna take a question from our vice president. No.
I'm good.
Okay, good. Then Member Epstein, you have a question or a comment? You're on mute.
I was trying to get through this whole day's meeting without saying anything, but I've gotten so confused that I absolutely have to ask. And following up on the Lieutenant Governor, Mark, could you give an example? Like, are you talking about if a student is like the head of Planned Parenthood on campus or something that they couldn't be prohibited from, I mean, what's an example of something a student could have done in community college that could meet this criteria?
So I think our non-discrimination language is, you know, fairly broad. It is about not discriminating against people on campus at the receiving institution. So that we want to ensure that the students who are transferring to the receiving students are in a fully accepting institution before we promote transfer to that institution. And that is a commitment that some institutions are not willing to make.
Could you give a real life example of a student in a college and the conflict that might occur?
Could I jump in, Mark?
I think I got.
So what I would say is that, you know, one example that we have had most recently is individuals who may identify with the LGBTQIA community who may not be eligible or invited to participate in transfer to institutions that do not, that do not recognize that community and or have other biases against having those students join their community. And so if we enter into a statewide agreement with those institutions, fundamentally, many of our students would be actively disenfranchised from trying to make use of those statewide transfer agreements. And so I think that's a concrete example that we continue to wrestle with as we look at statewide agreements across a number of potential transfer institutions.
Thanks. It's a perfect example why I never wanted to be a lawyer after going to law school.
Okay. Are there any other questions from our board? I don't see any other hands raised. Is there public comment?
The public comment period for item 5.2 is now open. Please use the raise hand feature. If you're calling into the meeting, use star 9. A member of the chancellor's office will call on you and allow you to address the board. You'll have a maximum of 3 minutes. We have not received any written comments on this item, and I will now turn it over to Gary for hands raised.
There are no hands raised at this time for this item.
So this is a reminder, this is a first reading of this. Let me just say that I think the legal aspects got very complicated the real issue around areas of real concern about the acceptance of differences, and especially around gender identification, and our laws are very, very broad relative to that. And so we just want to make certain that the colleges in terms of transfer are open to a broad swath of our students, and that they're not discriminated, or at least they know that they may be discriminated against if they decide to go to one of these colleges, and they may still want to for religious reasons, and that is still open to them. But it really is about our stance as a system on making certain that we do not in an affirmative way agree with that kind of situation. So I just wanted to sort of add that to the conversation. And I wanna let you know it's 4:30 and we have one more item that we're gonna get through, and it's 6.4. And it is informational. It's Vice Chancellor O'Brien. And thank you so much for hanging in there, David.
Thank you so much, President Haynes. Good afternoon, board members. Good to see everyone. I anticipate this being a fairly quick item, at least on my end, but I'm pleased to be able to present item 6.4, the state and federal update, with a PowerPoint, as promised. I think last time I was doing a lot of reading to you all off the item, and it was suggested to me that perhaps a visual aid would help with the discussion. So next slide, please. There's a couple of things. Obviously, there are the written items, which has the state policy and advocacy update, a bill analysis for one bill we'll be discussing in a moment, and our federal policy and advocacy update. But before we get into that, there are just a couple of items that I wanted to briefly mention here. I'm not going to go into detail about the budget because that is Vice Chancellor Navarette's area. And tomorrow, she'll be covering a lot of this in her adopted state budget item. But I did want to just highlight a couple of items that started as legislation. And they were legislation that the Chancellor's office either sponsored or strongly supported that were funded in the budget. We were very pleased to see that. So Assembly Bill 417, which we sponsored this year, establishes the Rising Scholar Network, a new network of supports for justice-involved students that includes students who are currently incarcerated as well as those who are formerly incarcerated attending the community colleges. And creates a new funding stream for this network of $10 million. We really want to thank Assemblymember Kevin McCarty for his leadership around this area, as well as our team here at the Chancellor's Office and the Foundation for their steadfast support for this one. Also wanted to highlight for you that Assembly Bill 775 by Assemblymember Mark Berman. This was a bill that our Student Senate co-sponsored along with the John Burton Advocates for Youth. We were also pleased to support. We supported it on the condition that it was funded in the budget, and we were pleased to see that it was funded in the budget. This was legislation that requires the identification of a basic needs coordinator and a single streamlined basic needs center on every community college campus. You know, as you know, in recent years, The board has been very involved in this issue, going back to before the passage of the landmark basic needs resolution last year in September 2020. But this board certainly is very familiar with their urgent need to address students' needs around food and housing and other basic needs in a streamlined and centralized manner, rather than continuing to reinforce silos and send students all over campus. So we were pleased to see that this legislation was funded, and I'm pleased to announce that in part thanks to board member Epstein for making the introduction, we were able to bring on a graduate student intern, Rachel Brand from UCLA. She's currently a student in the Masters of Social Work program there. And we are, Rachel is leading a project here at the Chancellor's Office this summer to help develop a digital toolkit for campuses and some best practices that we're going to be recommending to campuses as they scale up their basic needs efforts. Because we recognize that this is something that we don't want to just take in the funds and institute this new policy. We want there to be some leadership and some baseline level of quality from the Chancellor's Office, including from our student voices, which is so important to this effort. A couple of other budget actions on legislation I briefly want to cover. Assembly Bill 1111, also by Assemblymember Mark Berman. This one is continuing through the legislative process, but it also there was some funding put towards this in the budget. There was funding, $10 million one time in funds for the Chancellor's Office to convene a work group on enacting a system of common course numbering throughout the community colleges system. You may recall that this was a recommendation of the Governor's Recovery with Equity Task Force. And it's something that, especially those of you that have been around the community college system for a while, are almost certainly aware has been debated for many, many years. And for the first time, or at least for the first time in some time, there has been some real legislative and budget push behind it. And so while this bill continues to work its way through the process, the governor's budget and the legislature's budget did create some funds for the Chancellor's Office to convene a work group. And we're going to start doing that and looking at what it's going to take to implement this common course numbering system throughout our system, as well as hopefully involving our partners at the UC and CSU in that conversation, because there were a lot of stakeholders in that Recovery with Equity Task Force who were interested in seeing some form or some baseline level of common course numbering throughout all of the public systems of higher education. The last one I just want to cover was $5 million in one-time funds to expand the Cal Law, they're called, or California Leadership Access and Workforce Pathways. This is a pathway that is designed to particularly increase the diversification of the legal profession, starting with students in high school who may have their eye on attending law school one day. And I want to give a very special shout out to our former general counsel and now president of Foothill College, Thuy Nguyen, for her leadership and advocacy around this effort. All right, continuing on, I will pause for questions as usual after the state legislative update, but we wanna just give a couple of quick updates on what we've been up to in government relations here at the Chancellor's Office in advocacy the last couple of months. And so while we were disappointed to see that Assembly Bill 1456, the Cal Grant Reform Act, was not funded in the final state budget, there was some expansion of Cal Grant eligibility in the final state budget, including the removal of the arbitrary restriction based on how long a student's been out of high school. That shouldn't matter in terms of a student's eligibility for financial aid. And that was one of many rationing mechanisms in the Cal Grant program that disproportionately discriminated against community college students. So very, very pleased and thankful to the legislature and the governor for repealing that restriction. We did sign on to the Cal Grant so-called equity framework, Assembly Bill 1456, and continue to hope that the bill will work its way through the legislature and pass this session. We testified in support of several bills in legislative policy committees, including Senate Bill 26 related to student athletes, which I'll discuss in the next slide, as well as Senate Bill 512 related to Foster Youth and the Next Up program. Really want to thank the John Burton Advocates for Youth and Senator Dave Min for taking on that legislation. We continue to engage legislators, partners, and other stakeholders in all high priority legislation, including a couple that I'll touch on in a later slide, Assembly Bill 927 on our baccalaureate programs, and Assembly Bill 928 on transfer and the ADT. And we suggested some amendments to both of these bills, which I'll discuss a little bit. And then finally, I wanna just give everybody the heads up that we've already begun planning efforts for the 5th annual Board of Governors Undocumented Student Action Week. This year is particularly notable for a couple of reasons. For one thing, the Undocumented Student Action Week was created during a different time politically. And while we're very pleased to see that there is a less antagonistic administration and party in power as it relates to our undocumented students, we certainly want to keep up our advocacy around equity efforts for the student population. And it's also especially notable because this year is the 20th anniversary of the passage of Assembly Bill 540, which first expanded access to our higher education institutions for eligible undocumented students. So we're celebrating really a landmark piece of legislation, and please do look for more information regarding this year's celebration and our week of action very soon, because we hope you'll be able to join us for that. Okay, so on this next slide here, I just want to briefly cover three new bills that we have brought forward with an official policy position, one of which is relevant to the discussion we just had. And President Haynes, thank you for calling out the equity issue as it relates to gender identity. So we are supporting Assembly Bill 245 that would require public institutions of higher education to update its former students' records to include their updated legal name or gender if that student provides documentation demonstrating that they've changed their legal name or updating their gender identity. And so that is very much consistent with our equity priorities for the LGBTQ plus population. Please support that legislation. Assembly Bill 396 by Assemblymember Gabriel, very, very wonky, so I'll do my best to keep it at a summary, but essentially this is legislation that aims to break down barriers that prevent students from accessing CalFresh, which is the food assistance program known at the federal level as SNAP, formerly known, no longer known as food stamps. Essentially, there's a federal regulation in place where if a program of higher education is designed to increase what they call employability, then a student may have easier access to apply for CalFresh. And so this creates a process, a streamlined process for programs of study at the community college level in California to certify that they're designed to increase employability. Seems pretty straightforward, but something that requires legislation. So we're very supportive and thankful to the author for that legislation. And then finally, the Senate Bill 26 is the bill for which we included a bill analysis in your packet. We don't always include the full length bill analysis, but did want to take just a moment here to discuss this one because it was discussed a little bit at our previous consultation council meeting. This is legislation that implements prior legislation. So if you want a good analogy, think about AB 705 and then AB 1805, I suppose. But this is legislation by Senator Nancy Skinner, who's really been one of the leaders in the country on this issue, around equity for student athletes. So you may recall that a couple of years ago, Senator Skinner authored a bill, Senate Bill 206, which aimed to address this issue of inequity in how student athletes can be compensated. Right now, student athletes are the only type of student on most college campuses who cannot be compensated for the use of their name, image, or likeness by a corporation or by another company. And this comes up in the modern context for those of you. If you're a little older like me and you're thinking about Michael Jordan in the Wheaties box, it's actually more likely that it's something like Instagram or TikTok, because a lot of students use money from being what they call a social media influencer to help afford their total cost of attendance, which anybody who's listened to me say just about anything for the past 5 years is aware that the total net cost of attendance for community colleges in California is higher than it is for most UC and CSU campuses when you take out financial aid. So this is essential income and essential revenue to help students afford the total cost of college. And student athletes are the only type of student that are prohibited from being compensated for the use of their image or likeness. So Senator Skinner's original legislation created a work group that looked at this issue and made some recommendations. That work group was led here at the Chancellor's Office, and I very much want to give public recognition to Dr. LeBaron Woodyard, Adina, our Educational Services Division, who worked very, very hard on this issue for a couple of years. They recently released a report. I do recommend looking at it if you can. It's on the Chancellor's Office website. It is a very lengthy and detailed report about how the work group arrived at some recommendations. And the work group released a recommendation that new policy that student athletes could be compensated for these, their name, image, likeness, go into effect on or around January 1st, 2023. Well, as sometimes happens in the world of legislation, life moves a little faster or at a little different speed than those of us in the bureaucracy. And Senator Skinner, seeing that a lot of other states were adopting similar legislation around the country, and there's a recent Supreme Court decision that that ratified this as well, you may have heard. Senator Skinner did not want California to fall behind. And so she opted to speed up the implementation date of that provision to January 1st, 2022. It was not part of the work group's original recommendations, but given that it seemed to be now or never, and that it was very much in line with our priorities around equity for students and addresses a longstanding inequity, the Chancellor's Office chose to support this legislation with the earlier implementation date than the work group originally recommended. And an overwhelming majority of work group members that Dr. Woodard and his team reached out to supported it. And I want to thank the Student Senate as well for supporting it and for leading on this effort. I'm going to continue with the state legislative update. That may be one that there's an interest in coming back to, but for the sake of time, we can continue. Next slide includes three other bills we're looking at that we don't have positions on. I'll try to be fairly brief here, but they're all fairly substantive. We've discussed them a little bit before. Assembly Bill 927 by Assemblymember Medina. This one is sponsored by San Diego Community College District, and this is an effort that has been led with such dedication and passion by Chancellor Emeritus Constance Carroll. And we, of course, want to congratulate former Chancellor Carroll on her many years of service to the students of San Diego and for leading on this issue. This is legislation to extend the operation of the statewide baccalaureate degree pilot programs indefinitely and to lift the cap on the current 15 districts that may have a program. The legislation, not gonna get into detail about it, but it establishes a process by which if UC or CSE, one of the other public systems, feels a proposed program that's come to the Chancellor's Office is duplicative of a program that they offer in their system, that they can file an objection, and there's a formal consultative process that goes on between the two systems. This is very much part of the original intent of the baccalaureate programs. And we did originally have some concerns over how that consultative process would play out and how the final decision was made. But after some conversations last week, we were very pleased to secure a verbal commitment from the sponsors to work with us on amendments addressing those concerns. So it's a long story short, and I'm sorry I don't have more written information in your packet here, but our position that we'll be recommending on this legislation is support if amended to address some of those concerns. Happy to answer any questions about that one. Assembly Bill 928, I believe we talked about extensively last time. This is Assemblymember Berman's legislation sponsored by the Campaign for College Opportunity to reform the transfer process and in particular to create an ADT Intersegmental Implementation Committee. Just wanna say that although we're not at a point where we have a position yet, we very much appreciate the author and sponsors working with us and wanna commend them and the fact that they have accepted multiple amendments that we suggested to the bill. We're still working with them on a couple of more amendments that we're hopeful that they will consider. But it's been a pleasure to work with them throughout this process. Finally, Assembly Bill 1273 by Assemblymember Rodriguez. This is a bill related to what's colloquially often referred to as earn and learn job training opportunities that our Workforce and Economic Development Division is very familiar with. The aim of the bill is to require the Department of Consumer Affairs and the Department of Public Health to use licensing or certification standards that lead to more quote unquote earn and learn opportunities, which we're supportive of at the Chancellor's Office. They're opportunities for students to earn educational, to gain more education and skills and training literally on the job while being paid for, while being compensated. However, due to the way it's written, some of our colleges and some of our colleagues in WED had raised concerns that it could actually be detrimental to some of those. So without going into too much detail, but take a drink every time I say that today. Without going into too much detail, we are working with the Assembly Member's Office on language there to address those concerns. All right, the last slide here, thank you for your patience under the state update, is about a couple of upcoming deadlines we just wanted to alert you to. This week will be the last day for bills to pass out of their second House Policy Committee. So there are a couple of very big legislative hearings this week. And then from here on out, the policy committees, that's the Education Committee in the Senate and the Higher Education Committee in the Assembly, they will be done for the remainder of the legislative session. The legislature summer recess will begin later this week. There will be 4 weeks of 4 weeks until the legislature returns. And then there will be sort of a marathon 4 weeks of fiscal committees, floor votes, and then they will adjourn on September 10th. And of course, complicating all of this, as you're all aware, is the date that we don't have listed on here. It's not an official part of our process, but everybody who follows politics in California is aware that on September 14th, just a few days after the legislature adjourns for the year, will be the recall election for the governor. And then October 10th is the last day for the governor to take action on legislation, sign or veto bills that are on the governor's desk. Okay, I'm gonna take a breath and see if there are any questions on any legislation before we move on to a brief federal update.
Do we have any questions for David? Member Epstein.
Thank you. So I have a few questions about the bills under review. Hopefully this will go quick, but 89, the peace officers moving the age from 18 to 25, how would that affect community college students who take the peace officer training?
Yeah, that's a good question. That's one we've been looking into. I don't have the numbers in front of me. I apologize, board member, but that is one that we have looked at with the awareness. I don't want to say concern, but we've looked at with the awareness that it could lead to a drop in enrollment for our police academies. And we have some data, I believe. Again, like I said, I apologize. We could get that for you. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but just from a pure numbers standpoint, setting aside any policy merits the legislation may or may have, there could be a negative impact there.
Okay. Then AB 99 on the Cradle to Career data system, that was funded in the budget, right? And we've been supportive of that. What is there about the bill that has inhibited us from embracing it?
Nothing at this time. It's just that for various reasons, due to the fact that there's a lot of language in both this and the budget funding that's changing constantly, it wasn't at a point where we, you know, decided to go ahead and take a position on it. But AB 99, it was funded in the budget. So that bill, that vehicle for the bill is not moving forward at this time.
Okay, and AB 289, I didn't really understand what the merit system is. That's a new term to me, and the tabulation committee, I've never heard that term before either. What is that about?
On that one, I'm gonna have to plead ignorance, board member, and say that we'd be happy to get back to you with more information.
Okay. And the part-time faculty increase from 67 to 85%, is that something that the districts support or oppose, and as well as the faculty? I'm curious where everybody is on that one.
ACCA is officially opposed on that one. I think, as we look at that on our end, we're not weighing in at this time. I believe that would fall under our principle of it falling under district collective bargaining, so not being necessarily something we would weigh in on. But there is quite a bit of back and forth on that issue.
Okay. And just the last one, I noticed that in the comments, on the regulation that we've considered today by Chancellor Rodriguez from the LA Community College District on the transfer regulations. He talked about AB 1040 and encouraged us to endorse it because it had expedited course approval, a smoother path to CSU transfer and portability. In his comments, there was a lot of information about that. Do we have a position? I mean, where are we headed on 1040? What are our considerations?
Yeah, we don't have a position on the bill at this time. We very much appreciate Chancellor Rodriguez and LACCD for their leadership and, you know, bringing forward this issue and bringing it so much attention. But, at this time, we're supportive of the regulations that the board has adopted and feel that the regulations do cover what is in Assembly Bill 1040. So that's not to track from 1040, just to say that we don't have a position and have been focused on and are supportive of the regulations.
Okay, thanks.
Are there any other questions from board members? I don't see any. Do we have any public comment?
We do. We have two hands raised at the moment. But Andrea, did you want to go over the public comment procedure?
Oh, I was actually going to ask President Haynes, since he does have a federal review, do you want to take public comment at the end?
Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot about the federal review. I'm sorry, David, for cutting you off. Let's have David complete it, and then we'll take public comment.
Thank you. Not a problem, President. It's no problem at all. I will be fairly quick. The federal policy and advocacy update is largely reflective of what you may have been reading in the news lately, which is that there is a major impasse at the federal level. The Biden administration and Democratic allies in Congress are continue to negotiate over the American Jobs Plan and the American Families Plan. The American Jobs Plan in particular, which is the infrastructure legislation that the Biden administration has proposed. That is one that Republicans in Congress have engaged in negotiations with in an attempt to bring down the total cost and cut out some elements to limit it to what they call quote unquote hard infrastructure like freeways and roads. But so negotiations do continue there. We're supportive of it because it includes significant funding for community colleges. We're also pleased to see President Biden's fiscal year 2022 budget request, which includes several priorities of the Biden administration that you've heard many, many times before, including 2 years of tuition-free community college for all Americans, including Dreamers and DACA students, which is a major part of our advocacy, a substantial increase to the maximum Pell Grant. In fact, the largest proposal for the largest one-time increase to the Pell Grant in history, as well as significant increases in career and technical education and new funding for what so-called wraparound services to close college completion gaps for institutions that serve large numbers of high-income students or low-income students, excuse me. There are other components of the president's budget or legislation that I'm happy to address if there are any questions, but wanted to be quick recognizing the time, President Haynes.
Thank you for that brevity. Now I can ask if, are there any questions from my colleagues on the board relative to the federal report? Not seeing any, I think it's now appropriate to take public comment.
The public comment period for item 6.4 is now open. Please use the raised hand feature. If you're calling into the meeting, use *9. A member of the chancellor's office will call and allow you to address the board. You'll have a maximum of 3 minutes. We did not receive any written comments on this item, and I will now turn it over to Gary for any hands raised.
Thank you.
We do still have two hands raised. So let's start with Dr. Larry Glizio. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Thank you, Gary. President Haynes, Vice President Costa, members of the board, Chancellor Oakley, Larry Glizio, Community College, League of California. And as part of the league also includes the 3C2A, California Community Colleges Athletic Association. And I, you know, in terms of Senate Bill 26, we have quite a bit of frustration. We have a very good relationship, the league does and the GR team does, with Vice Chancellor O'Brien, He's great to work with. He's very smart. He's very collegial, and we enjoy a good relationship. But I do think it's important to know, as we continue to work to advance a good relationship, I want the Board of Governors to know what happened on Senate Bill 26, where a legislatively mandated work group included the board president for the 3C2A, Dr. Erica Andrujanis, the superintendent president of Pasadena City College, and also interim executive director for the 3C2A, Jennifer Cardone. And both of them were part of this legislatively mandated work group on Senate Bill 26. That's the name, image, and likeness for student athletes. And regardless of where individuals were on the particular bill, it's the process that was problematic. Number one, after working very hard for a year, and again, the 3C2A is going to be central in implementing this and overseeing this. And it's an office of four people right now. And so their voices are very important. A letter went from the chancellor's office supporting Senate Bill 26 against the recommendation of the work group, which asked for a 2023 start date because they have to implement and it's going to be very challenging. We understand politics works on its own set of conditions, but the notification was late. The letter implied that there was unanimity among the work group when key stakeholders did not agree with it. So just hoping that as we move forward, there can be a lot better consultation and that the important people that are going to be in charge of implementing laws are central to the work, and that there's clarity when the districts or when individuals who work at the districts have a distinct perspective than does the chancellor's office, because that's not what the letter had indicated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next we have Jeffrey Baum. You have control of your mic and can address the board.
Good afternoon, President Haynes, Vice President Costa, Chancellor Oakley, members of the Board of Governors. My name is Jeffrey Baum. I am an executive director of Michelson Philanthropies and Michelson Center for Public Policy and a former colleague of yours on the Board of Governors. And I'm just here to speak with admiration on behalf of the Michelson Center for Public Policy, which is focused, among other things, on empowering students and meeting the needs of students and removing obstacles for the effective advocacy of this board, the legislature, and the governor in recognizing what's needed in this unforeseen past year of issues. We're focused on student basic needs. The funding that you were able to achieve for student basic needs is incredible. We would like to see that continued in a sustainable way. We also appreciate the system's support for serving students who happen to be incarcerated. We are a sponsor of SB 416 that prioritizes educational access for incarcerated students. The system supported it. We're working closely with the Foundation for California Community Colleges, and we anticipate that passing through the legislature. So thank you for that. And then, of course, we've been focused on reducing costs for students and advocating for zero textbook cost degree pathways and for the governor to and wholly support the governor's recognition that the textbook industry is a racket and it places usurious costs on the backs of students that needs to be addressed. And we are 100% in support of the development of the pathways and looking forward to working with the system in ensuring effective execution of the $115 million that the governor's put into the budget. But I want to take this last moment, and I don't know if he's there, but to say one of the most powerful advocates that I've served with and have witnessed is our student trustee, Colm Fitzgerald. He has been an incredible voice for students and a powerful voice for students. And I just want to recognize what a excellent board member he's been and add my voice of and our organization's thanks to him for his leadership. In fact, he shared with me on the textbook issue, he had to pay $400 for a digital textbook for a class last semester to get across.
30 seconds.
And understood the need to do that. But on so many issues, COLM has really brought to the forefront the needs of students. And I think that the whole system has benefited from his service. Thank you.
Thank you, former board member Baum. Are there any other public comments?
There are no additional hands.
Yes, sorry.
All right, thank you. There may be some further comment. I want to give Vice Chancellor O'Brien an opportunity to make those comments.
Thank you so much, President Haynes. Don't want to belabor too much of the board's time, but I just wanted to respond to Dr. Galizio if I could, and remind the board that we've had this discussion at Consultation Council already. Dr. Woodyard and the Ed Services team working under Dr. Aisha Lowe reached out to all members of the SB 206 working group, and 10 out of the 13 members supported our recommendation to support the legislation with the earlier implementation date, including all of our student members. And of course, board members know that we are here to unapologetically advocate for student equity and student success. So thank you.
Thank you so much for that. With the conclusion of this particular item, I'd like to be able to adjourn until tomorrow morning, the word is not adjourn, is it? There's some other term one uses. We're all coming back tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. to conclude our board meeting. We do have about 5 or 6 items on there. So your ability to get here on time will determine your ability to get out, because we're hoping to conclude this meeting at 12 o'clock noon tomorrow. So I look forward to seeing you all at 9 a.m. sharp, as they say. Thank you.
This concludes day 1 of the Board of Governors meeting. Thank you so much for joining us today.